started early. Thousands of young college men playing basketball on home courts. It officially began last October 15th when 251 teams began practice, each with a dream of winning the national championship. As the season progressed, the weak were eliminated. In early March, 32 teams qualified to play in the championship tournament. After two intense weeks, 32 became four. The four regional champs came here to St. Louis with hopes of a national title. Tonight, two remain. And just 2 hours from now, there will be but one. That team will replace Al McGuire's Marquette champions of last year. Tonight we crown the 1978 national champion of college basketball. NBC Sports presents the National Collegiate Basketball Championship. Tonight's final, Kentucky's Wildcats meet the Blue Devils of Duke. This NBC Sports exclusive is being brought to you by Goose, Missouri, the dramatic finale to the exciting college basketball season.
Hello, everybody. The final, the toughest ticket in sports of the NCAA. Over 18,000 fans from all over America jammed into the Checker Dome here. And, of course, millions of you others viewing this championship game. I'm Kurt Gowdy. You're going to see a very interesting matchup. The youngest team to ever play for the national championship, Duke University, against a veteran Kentucky team that even before the season started was picked to win the national championship. Al McGuire. Al McGuire has been to the finals twice. 1974, he was there, lost to North Carolina State. Last year, he bowed out as the coach of the national champion Marquette team. You win on Saturday. That's the semifinals, Al. Now, what happens in only a day and a half until Monday night as a coach? It seems like a month, doesn't it?
It's more like a light year. I fell into a trap my first time in Greensboro. Even though North Carolina State was a great ball club, I was tired from coaches' meetings, from the press, from practices, from people wanting tickets. Joe Hall fell into the same trap 3 years ago against UCLA out in San Diego. You must be rested for the game. I don't think Bill Foster or Joe Hall will fall into that trap this time.
All right, here comes Duke out on the floor, and Kentucky will follow. We've had some thrilling games. Arkansas, at the buzzer, won the opening game as they captured, it's called a consolation, but it really decides third place for the national championship. And just an exciting finish. Ron Brewer, seven. They're down to six, to five. Notre Dame put on a great rally. Here's a shot now, up and in by Ron Brewer. Arkansas beat Notre Dame for the third place finish, 71-69. All right, let's take a look at the semifinals, and let's spot some of the players that you're going to be watching in this championship game. And here they are, real stars that have carried into the national championship.
The surprising Blue Devils of Duke, 27-6. Maybe the youngest team ever in the NCAA Finals. Their starting five averages 19 years of age. Number 43, Mike Gminski. He symbolizes this young Duke team. Can score outside, inside, averaging 20 points a game. And then there's the experienced veteran, although he's an old man at 20, a junior, Jim Spanarkel. Leads the team in steals. There he is again, number 34 against Notre Dame. When he gets the ball, he scores. Spanarkel, averaging 21 points a game. And one of the reasons, he's the right guy at the right time in the right spot. Watch the follow-up shot. Spanarkel, good position, and Duke gets two more. And then there's this sensational freshman from Philadelphia, 18 years old, Gene Banks. A one-handed catch in midair, great control, and a lay-in. Spectacular two for Duke. And of course, Banks, as it is with all the young big men, loves the dunk shot. Harrell spots him open, and Duke has two more against Notre Dame. But the inexperience of Duke found them wilting against Notre Dame in the late going, and had Duck Williams scored on this jumper, it would have been tied, but he misses. And Duke taps it away, and led by the youngsters, Gminski, Spanarkel, and Banks, Duke University, the underdogs, they were last in their conference last year, are in the finals against Kentucky tonight. The Wildcats of Kentucky, rated number one at the start of the season. They were number one in the polls all season long except 2 weeks. Led by Kyle Macy and the veteran clutch performer, number 21, Goose Givens. Here's Givens again, perhaps the most important basket as Kentucky beat Arkansas on Saturday. Givens, the number two scorer in Kentucky history. Another man to watch, Macy, the sophomore playmaker. Great passer, and he's a good shot from outside. And then there's the power man, number 53, the All-American Rick Roby. When he gets room inside, he usually scores. And then there's James Lee, the number six man, maybe the strongest forward in basketball at 6'5". And Jay Scheidler, the youngster, a sophomore. He can hit from outside from any range. Kentucky with depth inside and outside. Joe Hall trying to march in the steps of Adolph Rupp and win Kentucky's fifth NCAA title against Duke tonight.
Well, they say a child shall lead them. Two children have helped lead Duke into the championship. Two phenomenal freshmen. Gene Banks, number 20. He's 18 years old. And Kenny Denard, the other freshman, is 19 years old. And Billy Packer, what are they going to be when they're through with their careers at Durham, North Carolina?
Well, I don't know, Kurt, but they're enjoying themselves immensely out here. They played a great ball game on Saturday all the way through the playoffs. Of course, everybody heard about Gene Banks. He's a powerful young man. Great off the boards, catches the ball well, passes it well. Kenny Denard was not quite so heralded, but he comes in and does the same things with great quality. Super rebounder, a great runner on the break.
Over on the Kentucky side, when they went to the finals in 75, they had two freshmen, Rick Roby and Jack Gibbons. They're seniors now. This is their last chance, the seniors, to win the national title.
Now, they've got to feel some pressure in that, but these are two quality young people in addition to being great basketball players. Roby's very versatile, big and strong, plays center or forward. Of course, Gibbons is a great 12-foot shooter. Had an outstanding game Saturday. I look for both of them to lead their club well.
All right, get over there and analyze.
Well, we'll see, Chris.
Okay. Billy Pack. Say, Al, this is tougher than coaching, isn't it?
Oh, my God. I'd rather be on the bench than here tonight.
All right, we have a paradox here. Experience should lessen pressure. Yet I think there is more pressure on a veteran Kentucky team than a young Duke team, because no matter what happens tonight, Duke has had a glorious season.
Yeah, they've won their trophy already. For Kentucky to have a good season, they got to win tonight. There's three ways that Duke must do to beat Kentucky. Number one, they must handle Kentucky's 1-3-1 zone. They must be able to shoot from the perimeter. Number two, they must neutralize the boards. They must win the war on the boards. That's how they beat Notre Dame Saturday afternoon. And number three, their players mustn't wake up. They're in a dream. If they wake up, they'll go into shock, because here they're the youngest team that's ever been here. Now, for Kentucky to beat Duke, number one, they must stop Duke's transition game. They must get Duke to dribble the ball on the floor. Number two, they must slow down against Duke's zone, take the high percentage shot. And number three, the players must look at this game like an anchor in the water. They can't jerk the anchor out. They must pull it out link by link.
We'll be talking more at halftime about the strategy, what happened in the first half, what to look for in the second half. Thanks, Bill.
Thank you, Kurt.
All right. Calling a play-by-play tonight will be Dick Enberg, who's done a superb job all year long as NBC's play-by-play announcer on their college basketball program Saturdays and Sundays. Welcome, Dick.
Curtis, thank you. I remember about 10 years ago, you said someday we'd be standing here and doing a big game like this, and you know many of the coaches who have won this tournament, and I think it's a coach's story. Joe Hall has all the pressure on him. He'd like to join the Rupps, the Ivas, the Wooden. But Joe Hall is 29-2, and if he doesn't win tonight, he's had a bad year. All the pressure's on Kentucky, but I think they might be mature enough to handle it.
All right, Dick, good luck.
All right,
get back there, and we're looking forward to your play-by-play. I'll be back at halftime. Right now, we're going to join Bill McDermott here at the Checker Dome at the public address system with player introductions, and they're going to come right after this message.
Baby!
Gentlemen, the starting lineup for the 1978 NCAA Championship. First, the forwards from Duke, number 20, a 6'7" freshman from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, Eugene Banks. From Kentucky, number 21, a 6'4" senior from Washington, Kentucky, Jack Gibbons. Number 33, a 6'7" freshman from South Coast, North Carolina, Kenny Denard. From Kentucky, number 53, a 6'10" senior from New Orleans, Louisiana, Rick Roby. The centers from Duke, number 43, a 6'11" sophomore from Monroe, Connecticut, Mike Gminski. Number 55, a 6'10" senior from Manchester, Ohio, Mike Phillips. And the guard, from Duke. Number 22, a 6-foot sophomore from Durham, North Carolina, John Carroll. From Kentucky, number 4, a 6-foot, 3-inch sophomore from Peru, Indiana, Kyle Macy. From Duke, number 34, a 6-foot, 5-inch junior from Jersey City, New Jersey, Jim Spanarkel.
Faces of the players told the story. Young Duke smiling. They've already had a winning year. It's a very serious senior-oriented Kentucky team. Who will be the national champion? We'll unravel that story for you with the opening tip-off in just a moment.
Better than your car's original parts. Know where I get them?
A beauty, isn't it? Were the parts hard to find? Let's say I had a good source.
Where do I get my parts? Who's got over 50 years in the business, besides me?
Who should you see for your auto parts needs? NAPA. We help keep America moving.
Coming or going on a business trip, you've got no time to waste. And nobody knows that better than Hertz. Whether it's picking up or dropping off your Ford or other fine car, nobody has more to do it faster.
Representing the Atlantic Coast Conference, 27-6, and from the Southeastern Conference, Kentucky, 29-2. Kentucky in the white, Duke in the blue. We're set. Officials Jim Bain from Decatur, Illinois, Roy Clymer from Tulsa, Mr. Bain from the Big Ten, Mr. Clymer from the Big Eight. And immediately a position problem as Truman Clater has to give ground. Denard insisting that's his spot. Crowd of over 18,000. The pressure on Joe Hall and the Kentucky bench. And Bill Foster, the Duke head coach. Kentucky wins the tap. And it's Kyle Macy, their quarterback, number 4. Inside immediately and knocked, away. As Roby tried to take it inside. Out of bounds to the Blue Devils of Duke. Duke, in beating Notre Dame, ran off to a big halftime lead, 14 points. Built it to 16 early in the second half and held on for a four-point win. Kentucky in this tournament. Oh, turnover. Harrell made the pass. Denard was not there. And understandably, the first two possessions, one aside, wind up in turnovers, Billy.
Kentucky in a tight man-to-man defense. Phillips on Gminski will be interesting. Duke in 1-3-1 zone right off the bat.
Macy with Phillips moving in and out of the post, high and low. Roby playing the side. Macy and Clater, both outstanding shooters from outside. This is Clater from Toledo, Ohio.
Kentucky has about as many patterns against the zone as anybody in the country, and they work them off very well with good pace.
Truman Clater. Rebound Denard, one of the freshman forwards of Duke. Spanarkel, their playmaker. Captain to Gminski. Blocked beautifully, but a foul on Phillips of Kentucky.
This is something Mike Phillips is really going to have to be aware of, is the fact that Gminski goes the length of the floor from offense to defense and vice versa, as well as anyone in the country. Good catch. He's going up for the stuff. Phillips times it well, but he did hit him.
Boy, Phillips almost banged his head on the underside of the backboard. He was flying through. Gminski, all-A student, finished high school in 3 years. He has a couple of B's at Duke University, but at 18, already a sophomore, they say he may become the best center ever in the ACC. And Duke takes the early 2-0 lead.
Al, how important is it to get two up on the board?
Well, it's very important for the younger team. I was just thinking of Gminski's high school coach. He must be very upset when he left after his junior year.
One-on-one, Roby on Gminski, and he scores! Rick Roby, the All-American big guy for Kentucky, and Gminski, who rarely fouls, could not block the shot.
And so Duke throwing a full-court zone press against that. Gminski, a good shot blocker.
Spanarkel, not there. Gminski rebounds, but he fouls in the process. First foul for Duke goes to Gminski. Bill Foster, he was named co-coach of the year by the Coaches Association. He and Abe Levin, the stink honor, and your own colleagues picked you as coach of the year. And on the other bench, Joe Hall, some say he should deserve it.
A lot of good candidates for that. You can see Duke is not going to press unless they get a situation where they've just made a foul shot.
Later with Denard.
High-low post right now with Phillips and Roby down in low. That's a tough twosome in there.
10 years ago, Al McGuire, you never used a pick against the zone, but today that has even been added to the Kentucky offense.
Yeah, they pick the high, the front line of the zone. They'll pick and go for the 15, 16-foot jumper from the angle from the basket off the foul line.
And, Dick, they're matching up right now. That's what's confusing Kentucky a little bit. Although it's a zone, they're taking men in the area, just as you see Spinarkel going back on Clayton. Good pass.
Nice pass given. Can't hit. And the foul will be on Phillips of Kentucky, and that's his second. He is the most foul-prone of the Wildcats. He fouled out five times this year. Billy, another look.
There's an excellent pass to set this up by Clayton. Good penetration right here. Sometimes you take one dribble too many, and that was the case there for Goose Givens. He went on in, missed the shot, and there's the foul coming over the top.
A 2-2 tie. We've played over 2 minutes. Carroll, blocked by Macy.
Not a big overplays right now. You're going to see some backdoors coming.
Phillips makes the steal. Banks to beat. And he can't hit, and the foul is on Gene Banks of Duke.
Phillips is down. I think he hurt himself on the fall. Banks was getting himself in position to draw the charge as opposed to trying to make the block, but Phillips took it all the way in. Now, Phillips really not the kind of guy you want in the open field, but he saw this. Now, there's Banks trying to get position. What Phillips did is a very good maneuver. There's where he hit his hip falling down. Very good maneuver as he went ahead and went sideways to the basket.
You know what happened? Banks kind of thought of his 240, 50 pounds. He kind of moved at the last second. That's why they called it a block instead of a charge.
Now, Mike Phillips from Manchester, Ohio. He broke all of Jerry Lucas's Ohio prep records. And Kentucky leads 4-2. The obvious question, Al McGuire, do both teams seem tight to you?
Yes, so this is the way a championship game usually starts. They've got another minute or so, they should relax.
Great give and go, but Denard misses the layup. So Spinarkel and Denard have missed layups the last two times down. Givens can't score, but he was fouled. Spinarkel, number 34 of Duke, gets the foul, and that will send Goose Givens to the line. Givens needs only 3 points to become only the second player in Kentucky history to score 2,000 points. And there he is. He's sitting on 1,997. What a great four-year star he's been.
Dick down on the other end of the court with the tough pressure that Kentucky's putting on man-to-man. Duke is going to have to go ahead without the ball, backdoor a lot, try to hit the man at the high post and cut off, as was the case for Denard before. Teams that overplay this way just force you to take away your normal offense.
Givens makes it 5-2. Givens raised in Lexington, went to Bryan Station High School. You see the I in the state of Indiana outline middle of the court. This is the Indiana University home court. It was transported from Bloomington here to St. Louis for this tournament. A rare miss by Givens, and Gminski rebounded for Duke. Blue Devils have only one field goal in nearly 3 minutes. Inside, Gminski, foul Roby, or is it Phillips? Phillips has his third.
Excellent positioning by Mike Gminski. Although he's just a sophomore, he sure has great court sense and savvy. Gets position, doesn't hold or push off. Good call by the official. Gminski is an amazing young player.
And thus far, Joe Hall has not made a move to substitute for Phillips with three.
Dick, I believe that Kentucky plays better with one center, either Phillips or Givens.
We're going to see Gminski, 5-4.
We're going to see James Lee in there quickly. He's over on the sidelines already, and Joe Hall talking to him. That makes him a lot quicker, and you don't give up much on the boards when you put Lee in the game.
Givens open his Clayton, and he rattles it home. Truman Clayton has his first bucket, and it's 7-4. Kentucky leads, approaching the 16-30 mark of the first half. Banks, a powerful freshman from Philadelphia. It won't drop for Banks, And Phillips gets the rebound for Kentucky. The Wildcats on the move, leading by three.
Kentucky with Kyle Macy, they're just beautiful to watch against the zone with their attack. They're very patient. They get into their various sets. There you see Macy going to the corner. Got the jump shot.
Phillips open, misses an easy one. Rebound Banks. Spanarkel has no advantage, so he'll slow it up. Pass deflected by Clater. And the score 7-4 as James Lee, number 32, comes in. That's Bill Foster, head coach of Duke. He's 47 years of age, his fourth year, a banner season beyond his expectations. For Joe Hall, it's been a tough year for a man who has coached a team to 29-2. He said it yesterday, pressure consistently on me to win, 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 and I have to win this one.
Dick, I think this game breaks down to Duke wants to win, Kentucky got to win.
That's well put, Al. 7-6 as Spanarkel hits his first hoop. We have 15 minutes and 40 seconds left in the first half. Arkansas beat Notre Dame for the third place honors on a last second shot by Brewer. Macy drills from the corner. 9-6, Macy's first basket.
Nothing will beat a zone attack any better than hitting the deep jumpers from the corner, and Macy and Clayton both good.
Nearly a 5 second count batted away by Givens of Kentucky. Givens is the complete player. Johnny Wooden, the ex-UCLA coach, paid him the high compliment. He's not only a great scorer, second best in Kentucky history, but an outstanding defensive player. Many fans overlook that talent. Away from the ball, the foul is on whom? Truman Clater of Kentucky, holding Spanarkel. Spanarkel has been playing in the tournament with a bad ankle.
That was a set play by Duke, trying to break Gminski long and then set a screen for Spanarkel going for the lob.
And Spanarkel may have injured himself. He'll be attended to as we have a timeout here at the Checkerdome in St. Louis for the NCAA Championship after 4.5 minutes. Kentucky 9, Duke 6. We return to our studios for this message. Spanarkel appeared to...
Well, the game was tied, but luck was on our side. Now it's all behind. Got blue ribbon on my mind. Naturally good Pabst, a lot to look forward to.
Hello, everybody. This is Lowell Thomas. Alaska, tough on people, tough on auto parts. So we took Motorcraft heavy-duty batteries, oil filters, and tune-up parts to Alaska, testing them in 50 GM, Chrysler, and Ford cars and trucks. After 6 months of Alaskan pipeline country, less than 1% of the parts couldn't take the punishment. No matter what you drive, wherever you drive, ask for Motorcraft auto parts from Ford. Tested tough in Alaska. So long.
College basketball coaches like Foster and Hall here tonight spend many hours on recruiting. The National Association of Basketball Coaches is vitally concerned that each athlete and his parents are fully informed as to what is permissible in recruiting and the type of financial aid which may be offered and accepted. For a free copy of a guide for the college-bound student-athlete, write Recruiting, NCAA, Box 1906, Shawnee Mission, Kansas, 66222. The preceding message furnished by the NCAA. Spanarkel appeared to suffer a cut on his elbow in that last fall, but obviously nothing serious. We see no tape or bandage. It's 9-6 Kentucky. Duke's ball, 15 minutes plus remaining first half.
With James Lee in the ball game, they match up to Duke's personnel. There's the same play. Well conceived, but Roby was right in the spot.
Roby did the good job, and there's Denard stealing it for Duke. What a play by Denard. Banks, Spanarkel. Spanarkel to Banks. And now Gminski. Rebound Banks. He can't hit. Both teams missing fairly easy shots. Roby ripping down the rebound for Kentucky. Good pass. Out of bounds to Kentucky.
What's happening, Dick, to Kenny Denard? He's staying down court trying to steal the pass. And we're going to see a play right here. Inside, Kenny Denard does steal that one. Great hands inside. Gives the ball up very well. Duke really not running as well as they did before.
Live action, Jack Gibbons lead. 5 points with 14:50 left. Inside to Banks. Good fake. It'll count if it goes, but it doesn't drop for Banks as the foul is on Kentucky. Joe Hall, sixth year. He's won 134 games. Gibbons, perhaps his premier player. He's been so consistent, has his first foul.
Dick, if Kentucky moves up to 8 points, they're going to go to the 1-3-1 zone. It's going to make it very difficult for Duke then, because they're so big, they take you out of your range, and you only get one shot against their 1-3-1 zone.
Banks drops it in there. His nickname is Tinkerbell because of his good humor. He's a happy man, and, well, he can fly, too, for that matter.
What I think is happening to Duke right now, being a young team, emotionally, they're exhausted. Now, in another minute or so, they should be able to get their composure again. Kentucky a little bit more used to this kind of pressure situation.
Now, Banks, two free tosses, his first points of the game. Cut Kentucky's lead to three, 14-41 left. Kentucky easily breaks the press. Roby helping out at midcourt. As you know, Billy, we'll be picking a player to receive the Gillette Most Valuable Player of the Game Scholarship Award. And tonight, that honor is worth $5,000.
1-3-1 half-court zone press now, Duke. They changed their defense a little bit. Much more active out here.
Later sets up your lead. James Lee ramps it home. He loves the power dunk.
There's experience for you, Dick. They saw the defense, recognized it, and just executed perfectly.
Intensive defense. Spanarkel. Harrell. Johnny Gunn, they call him. High arch in there. Harrell, who rarely shoots, bangs home his first bucket, and it's 13-10 Kentucky.
You made a good point there, Dick. He very rarely shoots, but you know what? He takes a lot of big shots in the game, which is very unusual.
In the corner, Kyle Macy, and he hits again. Macy, the sixth-grade sophomore from Peru, Indiana. Kentucky by five. Gminski can't hit. Rebound Roby. It's Clater, and the foul is on Clater.
Good call.
Denard had established position, and Clater did have one step.
It was a good pass by Clater. He split the zone. Lee took it in there, and he really is a great player inside.
Al McGuire, they say Lee's power dunk, they call it the Ernest Hemingway dunk.
Why?
Because when he ramps it home, it shatters the whole building and the earth moves.
Oh, for whom the bell's tolling.
15-10, oh. Kentucky leads Duke. The young Blue Devils trying to ward off the Wildcats, number one in the nation.
Suddeth into the ballgame now. Bill Foster looking for a little shooting.
Spanarkel can't hit. And Duke very cold. 13-10 and a turnover. And Lee gave Spanarkel a little shove up to say, you go get it because it's going to belong to you.
Joe Hall didn't want that pass thrown right there. He's got a working margin, 15-10. He'd like them to be a little bit more solid.
Number 21, Bob Bender, comes into the game for Duke University at a guard position. Bender played on the Indiana team that won the NCAA Championship 2 years ago. Transferred at midseason. There's that jump hook. Gminski's jump hook makes it 15-12. He has six.
Great shot. Roby is a good defensive player also.
He played 7 minutes. Inside Roby, blocked by Suddeth. Basket is good. Roby showing his power. The ball was blocked for a moment, and he still scores.
Good
look
pass
at this angle.
Good pass on the inside, actually. That was a case right there where Banks was not in the passing lane. Roby showed a great power move there and just overpowered Suddeth.
Duke cannot play a 1-3-1 zone against Kentucky. They're too powerful underneath.
That's right, Al. What's happening is the baseline man is being caught with real bad disadvantage. They'll probably go back to the 2-3 they used earlier.
Knocked away by Gibbons. What hand? And almost stolen by Roby.
Kentucky playing some tough defense out there, man.
Bender inside to Gminski, knocked away. Gibbons came up with a loose ball. Kentucky down court with a 5-point lead.
Here's a big basket. They hit this, they'll go to their 1-3-1 zone. Let's see if it happens.
19-12, 7-point lead for Kentucky, their biggest margin. It comes with 12 minutes, 15 seconds left in the first half. Now Kentucky stays in the man-to-man.
Now they might be thinking their man-to-man is so effective. Bad shot, but he got fouled.
James Lee had a piece of it. And another freshman, Jim Suddeth from College Park, Georgia, went up for that jumper, and Lee didn't like the call. His father is a Baptist minister in Lexington, Kentucky. He looks mean, but oh, is he tapioca inside.
Probably the best six man in the country. I'm talking about the guy from Kentucky.
James Lee. Well, he really made their team a lot different when he came in there.
A reminder that on Sunday, April 9th, that's 2 weeks from yesterday, NBC Sports World will feature from the University of Kentucky the USA All-Stars against the Russian team, USSR. Some of the great players for them from this Kentucky team will be featured 4 o'clock Eastern Time, 2:30 Pacific Time. That's 2 weeks from yesterday. Sutton has his first point. He's averaging 2.5 points a game from Woodward Academy in College Park, Georgia.
That's only 2.5 points a game, Dick, but this young man has really come on well, and he's another freshman on their ball club that really has some promise.
Well, you know, he's a standstill shooter. For him to get a shot off, one of his teammates have to pick him up.
And that's one of the reasons, of course, the 1-3-1 might be just exactly what he wants. He's coming out of the game. Bill Foster saying, well, they're going to play man-to-man. I've rested Denard long enough. Full court press.
The score is 19-14, not 19-15, and the foul is on Bender of Duke. Denard went out. That Denard is in for Jim Sutton for Duke University.
That was a sweat foul, high school foul.
Now they're dropping out of that press. The press really hasn't been very effective, primarily because Macy sees up court so well.
Al, so far it appears the officials are letting him play.
Yeah, they're doing an excellent job.
There's the 2-3 zone. They've gotten out of the 1-3-1 because of that power inside.
There's Roby. Oh, a nice move, but he can't score. Rebound by Getch, knocked away by Scheidler of Kentucky. So Joe Hall has made three substitutions. He has Scheidler, number 25, a sophomore. 32 Lee, also into the game. And for Duke, it's Bender. And number 44, Scott Getch, a six-time junior from Chatsworth, California, who has replaced Gminski.
Bill Foster uses substitutions to give fellas rest for about a minute and a half. And able to get by without a deep bench.
A foul called on Gibbons of Kentucky. His second. Now Jack Gibbons.
1-1 now, Dick.
Already, Kentucky has its seventh foul. It comes with 11 minutes, 25 seconds left in the half. Duke has 5 team fouls. So to the line goes Bender, I believe. Now it's going to be... No one wants.
Well, actually, what happened? It was the man without the ball that was fouled. Do you see Gene Banks going to go to the line? But I don't believe it was Gene Banks' foul.
Banks, 71% free throw shooter. 19-15, Kentucky. Chuck Alexinas, a 6'10 freshman from Morris, Connecticut.
They just go down to that bench and pull out another guy, don't they, Al?
Kentucky's number 50.
They seem to pull out a Clydesdale each time.
The right down for that. Press really hadn't been effective as far as bothering Kentucky at all.
Scheidler threw Alexinas' hands, and Bender comes up with it, and he is fouled by Alexinas, the big number 50. He's a giant young man, 6'10 and 250. It's interesting that Alexinas, 6'10 is from Connecticut, a freshman, and so is Gminski, went to Monroe, Connecticut. Two big men from a state not known for producing a lot of basketball talent. They've had their good ones. Here are two that have migrated away and potential big stars.
You know what's very important about making a pass like that, Al? You've got to remember who's on the catching end. Normally they'd have Roby catching that ball. Alexander doesn't have the same kind of hand.
Well, he just committed to the game, too. He's a freshman. He's a little nervous. The coaches are nervous. We're nervous. The fans are nervous.
Bender rattles it home. Remember, Duke is the best free throw shooting team in the nation this year. Kentucky's in the top 10. So far, they're 9-for-9. So Duke, 10-for-10. That's kept them in the game. They trail by only one.
It's interesting to see how long Bill Foster's going to stay with that full court press.
Roby helping out, throws it away.
First one tonight.
Intended for Lee, and Duke, leading 2-0 off the opening bell, has a chance to get the lead for the first time since.
There's a case Lee didn't come to the ball that time. He was open.
Duke's press, they don't try to steal the ball. They wait for you to throw it away.
Gminski can't hit a 15-footer. This is Scheidler. Oh. He's got a clear path.
Good move.
And it's tipped in by Roby. Rick Roby with a left hand follows it in for the Wildcats.
There's the value of the big man that'll be willing to run down the court. Roby and Gminski do it better than any two big guys around.
I thought Bender made a little mistake and he came up on the
challenge,
going back and protecting the basket.
Banks trying to get inside, double team, clears it to Spanarkel.
Bender. Gminski blocked, but a foul is on Lee of Kentucky. Lee is so strong, he blocked the ball, but when he came through on the block, he hammered the shooter, and Bill Foster looks at that scoreboard, 21-18.
Super camera work from up top. Excellent touch passing that time by Bender. May have charged Groby before that play, and there's Lee coming through, and you're right, Dick. He's so strong with those ham hock arms of his, he just ran right through Gminski.
What would you call a player like that, Al?
I'd call it hammering a guy to the floor with your elbow. His elbow caught his head that time, not his hand.
Gminski and Duke, perfect from the line. Gminski now 3-for-3. Duke is a team 11-for-11. And the sophomore, 18 years of age, looking for his eighth point. Boy, you give them free tosses, and that's what they are. They're 3 points for Duke, 21-20. Duke, 12 of their 20 points from the free throw line.
Back to the 2-3 zone. Now they're really changing up, trying to find the defense that they're comfortable with.
It's an active zone, and watch how they try to keep their hands up to make those passing lanes look closed.
Duke playing much better out of the 2-3 than they were the 1-3-1.
LeVon Williams, number 52, is in for Kentucky. He's the sophomore from Denver, Colorado, 6'6".
You watch Kyle Macy change their offensive pattern to go to the high-low. There it was right there.
Lee misses. Gminski rebounds. And Duke again, trailing by one. We're at the halfway mark of this first 20-minute period. Banks! Apparently dribbled it on the baseline.
This is interesting play. Gene Banks really showing you how explosive a young man here he is. There he goes. We couldn't see the legs right there, but they call walking on the play, but it was a great move.
Should have gave him a transfer. It's 3.5 steps, Billy.
Timeout here in St. Louis, Missouri, where Kentucky leads Duke by one. As NBC Sports...
Impossible!
America's waking up to the impossible shave. Gillette Atra. The first razor with a head that pivots to follow every contour of your face for closeness with comfort you never thought possible.
Impossible!
This Atra face-hugging action keeps twin blades at the perfect angle.
Such closeness with so much comfort, it's impossible!
Gillette Atra. Yes, the impossible shave is here.
For years, Abner tried to court Maybelle, but she was always distant, don't you know? So Abner drove to town, made a deal on a Kawasaki, and Abner swam the deepest river. He climbed the highest mountain, then he stopped for some flowers. Maybe he shouldn't have done that, because the woods is full of Kawasakis, but love conquers all. Kawasaki lets the good times roll.
Sports wraps up this exciting collegiate basketball year. Golf and, of course, baseball are ahead. First order of business will be followed by the Dynashore Colgate Classic from the Palm Desert area of Southern California. And don't forget, in that one, Arnold Palmer will be shooting for a hole-in-one that will be worth $1 million to someone. 21-20 Kentucky, a big play when Banks had a possible three-point play, but traveled.
Nick, there you see Kentucky changing their pattern now. They want to get a man on the high post.
Loose ball, and Williams picked it up. Gminski rebounds for Duke, the big guy averaging 10 a game.
Kentucky doing a great job getting back against the break, which has been one of Duke's best plays in the entire playoff.
Denard averaging around 10 points a game. Duke now has rested everyone. Great pass to Spanarkel, but he can't handle it cleanly. Does he save it? No, his foot was on the line. Jim Bain, the official, right there to call it. And let's hope Spanarkel's all right, helped off the Kentucky bench. That's joining the camp of the enemy.
Considering the score 21-20, that's not very a good idea to try that lob in here. What do you think, Al?
Well, I think the one that stopped it was Macy. Came over and stood still and made Spanarkel look down. That's why he dropped the ball. It would have been called for charge otherwise.
Jimmy's got the good hands, not a great leaper. Tough play to make up.
Yeah, but Kentucky from the weak side, they come over and block.
Kentucky has scored only 2 points in the last 3 minutes. Groby, and he was slapped. You could hear that one good right ball. Here at courtside. I believe it was Denard who got a hand on his wrist. That'll send Rick Groby to the line for Kentucky as Denard has his first foul.
Roby, all Southeast Conference, second team All-American. Well, you can see why Duke might be doing well. Debbie Ridley, she may be the first female manager to make it to the finals. Times are changing.
I think we'll pass on that and go on with the ball game.
Roby trying to make one out of two. So Kentucky is 4 for 7. Duke is a perfect 12 for 12. That's the difference, although Kentucky leads by 2.
Von Williams on Gene Banks. I think Gene Banks would like to have that ball a little bit.
Scheidler reaching in, and the foul is on Jay Scheidler of Kentucky. Al, it is very warm here in the Checkerdome. It was warm in the first game, and with all these active fans, I wonder if that might not be a factor as we look ahead.
Well, if anything, it's going to drain, has to hurt Duke, because their bench isn't as long as Kentucky. One of the key things about heat, as long as your locker room is not warm. Years ago, when people used to play games in basketball, they'd push the heat up in your locker room, you'd come out for the second half, and you were a basket case.
You mean if you were the home team, you kept yours cool and had the heat on in the other? That was the first miss by Duke, and it remains 21-20. Scheidler and Macy outside for Kentucky. James Lee, not there. Denard with a rebound. A 6'7" forward from King, North Carolina. Town so small that he says, I don't know how many we have, around 100.
Oh, it's bigger than that now, Nick.
He said they just got their first traffic light, and it also serves as the only street light in town. Banks ties for Duke.
He wanted that ball. He's been wanting it the last 3 times down the floor, and they finally got it to him.
Gene Banks with 6 points. Tie a knot at 22 with 8 minutes left in the first half.
You have to watch Macy try to dissect this zone.
The foul will be on Denard for bumping into the shooter, Roby. Roby scores.
Here's Gene Banks trying to get open. Really rubs off the screen well. Uses both Roby and Gminski. Gets the ball. He wanted for a long time, went up with a jumper right on the money.
Well, that's a tough 2 points. He earned it. Denard goes out with his second foul. And at the line, Roby shooting for the 3-point play. Jim Suddeth, the freshman, 6'6". Number 30 is in for Duke.
Kenny Denard leads the NCAA in floorboarding. Burns.
You know, the thing about Rick is the fact that when he gets that ball in tight, he explodes to the basket. And you know, he plays like he's about 6'5 or 6, but at 6'10, it's just amazing what a fine athlete he is.
Roby has his 10th point of the game. He set a new Kentucky record this year for field goal percentage, well over 60%.
There's a good rub off screen on the inside. Just Spanarkel.
Banks can't hit. Ooh, he goes down heavily. And the foul is on James Lee. You talk about 2 power players. James Lee, 32. 6'5 and about 230 for Kentucky, and Gene Banks. Boy, look as if somebody just cut open their skin and put iron inside there for muscles.
But Lee's 3 years older than Banks, and you can imagine what Gene Banks is going to be in the senior year at Duke.
That's 3rd on Lee, and of course, I think Phillips also has 3. So those are the interchangeable keys for Kentucky. A little bit of a problem here in the first half. A lot of time remaining.
Banks trying to cut into Kentucky's 3-point lead.
Rather unusual foul shot for a powerful man. He spreads his feet very wide. Really anchors himself.
Yeah, you should only put your feet as wide as your shoulders.
25-24. Banks a perfect 6 for 6 from the line. Has a total of 8.
And the zone defense full court changes to a 2-2-1 type press now. Really showing a lot of different strategies.
Nice pass, and it's given over to Gminski. Oh, what a soft
He's
touch.
Automatic from there.
27-24, the Wildcats, with 7 minutes, 20 seconds remaining in the first half. Kentucky has led almost throughout. Gminski, he has to have room to come down. Scheidler did not give him room to get his feet on the floor.
Scheidler kind of settled underneath him. It was an excellent call by the official.
Scheidler has his second foul, to the dismay of Joe Hall, the head coach of Kentucky.
Rick Roby, a little bit out of position that time. He got picked off by his own man. Excellent pass.
Bill Foster, his wife Shirley, father of 4 daughters. What a year it's been. He didn't even know if he'd get into the tournament. Here he is in the final game, and his young team is behind by only 2. Gminski is 5 for 5 from the line today.
He's always been a good coach, Dick. Matter of fact, he also is an ice cream addict.
that Rutgers and at Utah, fans there will recall bringing winners to those universities. In comes number 44, Kentucky, Fred Cowan. He's a 6'8 freshman from Sturgis, Kentucky.
Well, if you were a backcourt man that had that kind of view of the defense, you probably could score every time.
Great job with our cameras. We have 10 different cameras shooting the action of this 1978 championship game. Scheidler. Oh, a 22-footer by Scheidler. Makes it 29-26. He went home on Friday night. His mother's seriously ill. Didn't sleep much. Had a big game Saturday.
There's the 1-3-1 zone now for the first time by Kentucky. They do it with a three-point lead.
And there's the turnover, and it's Roby, the 6'10 senior, bringing it up court. Holds up well. Scheidler, he wants it. It's short, rebound. Cowan blocked Gminski, just tipped it away on the upward flight.
Great block by Gminski. Never knocks that ball out of bounds. He just goes up softly and gets a piece of it. Duke really needs to change their lineup in the ball game right now, but there's their shooter, Sutton.
Goes over the back of the board, out of bounds to Kentucky. Getting a little physical, and the official warning Roby and Getz to take it easy as they were in a shoving match.
Johal, he's taking Scheidler out, letting him sit down. Scheidler was so pumped up, he just wanted that shot.
Truman Plater has replaced Scheidler in the backcourt for Kentucky. 6 minutes remaining before the intermission.
Al, it's interesting how Bill Foster has been using his substitutes, giving everybody about a minute and a half rest periodically.
He's moving them on the clock, Billy. That's to keep them fresh, and also to shotgun the foul.
Spanarkel made the play, and that's Spanarkel with the ball, and he scores. That's why he's regarded as one of the top players in the country. He leads his team in steals. He deflected the pass. Duke got it, and it paid off for Spanarkel as he had the honors at the other end. 1 point game, 5 minutes and 40 seconds remaining. Ryan drives it home. It never appeared that ball was high enough to go home.
That shot was unbelievable. He didn't go more than 4 or 5 inches above the rim that he can.
And he made the great fake and made the jump shot on the way down. Super play.
He had 3 men in the air on the fake. 3-point lead for Kentucky. 5 minutes remaining. First half.
Looking for the lob pass, but without Banks and Denard in the game, it's not available.
Spanarkel outside. Tip, Gminski, nice play. He went up, found the basket, and kissed it off the glass. 31-30, Gminski with 11.
We'll see him in Russia in 1980 on NBC.
I'll tell you, that was just two great jump shots that we saw in a row there.
Later, looking for help, the cool Macy, a sophomore, into Gibbons. He scores again. Goose Gibbons, he's only 6'4", a forward. What a player. He has 11.
He did the smart thing there, Al, by not putting the ball on the floor. He's shooting it right to Gminski's face.
He says, there's one right in your face. Right back at you.
Cut it, passes up a good shot, so Bender fires. He can't hit. Rebound, Getz, foul is on Getz. Oh, that could have gone either way. Yep. And Bill Foster saying, hey, let's go into more revolving offense. Foster.
Both teams in a 1-1 now.
Foster attended Bloomsburg State. That's near where you grew up, isn't it?
Not too far away.
State of Pennsylvania. There's one of the Al McGuire faithful here to watch the action tonight. 33-30. He asked for your autograph 3 times tonight.
That matches some of the clothes he wears when he walks around town.
Oh, Billy, Billy, oh. God, I don't want to get into that.
Jack Gibbons hit the line.
You dress like Astor's pet horse, Billy.
All right, that's a technical. Gibbons rattles it home. He has 12 points for Kentucky.
Well, he's been the difference here in the first half. Great performance.
Dick Enberg with Al McGuire, Billy Packer with the Checkerdome in St. Louis. The championship game, the NCAA. And Kentucky has a 5-point lead, 35-30, as we have a timeout called. 4 minutes, 19 seconds remaining in the first half. The top-rated Wildcats lead the Final Four Cinderella Duke by 5. Well, then, there's one more.
I believe they can do it for $19.99.
Installed. The aluminized Sears muzzler is only $19.99 installed.
and read the Muzzler promise.
Sears promises that the Muzzler will last as long as you own your American-made car.
Or return it for refund or replacement free.
And if Sears installed it, they'll install the new one free.
Well, you can't beat that.
I think it's fantastic.
It's a great promise.
Sounds like one heck of a good deal.
The Muzzler, only $19.99 installed. Only at Sears.
It's a sun tire in the summer. It's a rain tire in the fall. It's a snow tire in the winter. It's the one that does it all. Goodyear's great TFO for all seasons, for all year. It moves through snow and ice, yet runs quiet in the clear.
Tiempo is a tough double steel belted radio with a special tread design for all kinds of weather.
Snow tire, rain tire, sun tire, one tire, Tiempo does it all.
Well, Dan, there's one more big game left here on NBC Sports in this college basketball year. Some of our all-stars against the Russians. 2 weeks from yesterday, listen to the names involved. Bailey of Rutgers, Bird of Indiana State, Carroll of Purdue, Gibbons of Kentucky, Lee Macy, Roby of Kentucky, Gerald Griffith of Louisville, Urban Johnson, Michigan State, Sidney Moncrief of Arkansas, David Greenwood, UCLA, Bill Ford and Michael O'Korn of North Carolina, and they'll be coached by this man, Joe Hall, who has said this has been a season without celebration for us. So much has been expected. We have to win tonight.
That's a tough road to follow right there, isn't it, Al, to be under that kind of pressure?
Well, coaches are tremendous competitive individuals. When you go to a heavyweight program like Kentucky, you're expected to win. But in Joe's 6 years, he's averaged over 22 wins a season. Coach Rupp, in over 40 years, averaged 21 wins a season. But he's done the papers that he would. And I just think it's been a long season, and he just needs a rest.
2-3 zone now by Kentucky for the first time tonight. They're changing things up themselves after the timeout.
Spanarkel inside, and the foul is on Spanarkel for charging.
Good play by Gibbons. He's doing everything right in the first half.
There's Hall. He's 49 years of age. He said, regardless of what happens tonight, I'll be feeding my cattle on the farm tomorrow. I have a feeling if he wins tonight, he won't have time for the herd. 35-30 Kentucky. With 3.5 minutes remaining in this first 20-minute period.
Both teams using the same defense now at 2-3. The difference being the fact that Gminski's up a little bit higher in his team.
Duke trying to check Kentucky, but the Wildcats can afford to be patient. They have the lead, 5 points. 3 minutes, 14 seconds remaining. Macy, the traffic cop in the Kentucky offense. That's Gibbons. He can't hit. Tapped out. Spanarkel's quick hands come up with it for Duke. Denard to Harrell. Denard is open. Inside to Gminski. Spanarkel.
Nice play by Duke. Very patient. Good passing, but what you've got to point out for Kentucky is the fact that they're not giving Duke any uncontested layups on that break. Getting back beautiful.
Gibbons to Williams, or Cowan it is. That's Plater in the corner. Too long, Spanarkel, and the break for Duke is on. Great pass to Denard, to Harrell, to Denard, inside, and he's on the baseline. That's a tough break for the Blue Devils. He went too far.
Yeah, trying to make some passes that really weren't there.
In contrast to the pressure under Joe Hall, this man can smile. Bill Foster, his team has gone much farther than he expected. He's going to go home a hero tonight regardless.
That's the way life is. He'd probably be given a lifetime contract tonight. But what happens, you build a monster and it ends up beating you. Coach Rupp has built the monster, and Joe Hall determined to take it over. He was on Coach Rupp's staff, and it's just the way of life in coaching.
Phillips missed the shot, and Duke had it, but again, it was Denard dribbling the ball on that red baseline.
Well, Kenny Denard, such an emotional basketball player. Both times he tried to rip the ball off instead of just patty-caking it.
35-32 Kentucky. We're down to the two-minute mark.
Unusual lineup that Kentucky has in the game right now.
There's a pick, and Gibbons hits it again. He's made four in a row. There's using a pick off his own defense. 15 for Gibbons. What a first half for the senior. Spanarkel in a crowd, banks it in. Three men on him, and Spanarkel rams home his 8th point of the game.
He's definitely a keeper, Bill. He has Houdini's hands, and he's so cool.
They say he's a fine student. He goes to the Scholastics the way he plays the game. Just solid, consistent, works hard. Dipped in by Gibbons. He is everywhere. How many 21s are there out there in a white uniform?
what's happening to Duke when the ball goes into Phillips. Nobody coming back in from the outside to cut him off. Therefore, he's got a lot of time to operate.
Spanarkel inside. He can't hit. Gets his own rebound, and he is fouled by Phillips. And that'll be the fourth. I think Mike Phillips of Kentucky.
Boy, determination. Wow, amazing. And, of course, he played with another guy, and everybody always talks about this, Mike O'Korn from North Carolina. They played on the same high school team. With their both great determination type attitudes, it must have been beautiful to watch him in high school.
Well, that's a lonely seat when you get four fouls in the first half. Spanarkel, a great free throw shooter, the best in the Atlantic Coast Conference this year, hitting over 86%, leads his team in scoring, free throw shooting, and assists, and in steals. 10 points for Spanarkel.
Here's the press back, first time in a while that Duke has been able to employ it.
It's a token press, Billy. It's not a serious type thing. They're just trying to break your rhythm.
Gibbons to Roby. Macy, they're looking for Gibbons. He's been the man that has shot them into the lead, and there he is again. Oh, tough break, but look at Williams. He misses. Tipped, and Denard has it. Who fouled? It is Roby or is it Williams? Williams of Kentucky. Levon Williams, the 6'6 jumping jack from Denver, Colorado, has his first foul. They're talking about Bill Foster. He's been wearing the same navy blue blazer vest and plaid slacks since his team beat Clemson in the first round of the ACC tournament. Don't ask him why change. He says, well, just getting to smell good.
That's terrible.
Putting the corner stands up by itself.
Well, it's been all winning, and you know the feeling. You wore that blue blazer a long time last year.
Yeah, last seven games, and when the season was over, I gave it to a educational channel, and they auctioned it off for $550.
They knew it was that much.
I think they get more for Foster's.
39-37 for the final seconds.
ACC 30.
Eugene Banks. He said he would have gone to the University of Pennsylvania, but they do not have the freshman eligible rule. How does that make you feel if you're the Penn head coach?
Same thing with Butch Lee and Marquette. He was supposed to go to Pennsylvania, but he didn't want to go with the freshman rule.
Listen to this. Duke University in the first half has made 20 of 21 free throws. They've missed only one, and they trailed by only one.
51 seconds, now 49. Let's see if Kentucky pulls it on out close to the last shot. A lot of time left.
Couldn't ask for more in this first 20 minutes.
If they don't get one off soon, they'll probably pull it back out.
They'll shoot soon, though.
Gibbons had it knocked away, controls it, and he scores it. And he's been sensational. Jack Gibbons has 17. They get 19 for Gibbons.
Come catch that time by Gibbons.
20 seconds left in the half. Dump it inside to Gminski. Can't get up a good shot.
Great block out by Roby.
Time for Kentucky to add to its lead. It's Gibbons again. Oh, my. What a play by Jack Gibbons. 6 seconds, 5 seconds, and the foul is on who?
It's a big call here.
It could be either man. They're pointing at both of them.
It's a big call right here.
Very important, this call.
Yes, Banks or Gibbons.
Who is it?
We got a 5-point spread here. It's big.
It's a big, big it's on. Call. What do we have?
He hasn't given us a signal yet. It apparently is on Duke University. So Gibbons will go to the other end.
That could be close to costing the game. So many games are won in the last few seconds of the first half.
We'll see the play coming up right here. There's now 3 seconds on the clock. You're going to see Banks go in. He pulls up. Going to try to slide through. Gibbons was there. Good call by the official.
As long as your feet are there, you can move your body then, because he definitely shifted his body into the man while he was in midair.
He was in position. Boy, that's a big, big turnaround when you consider how many points were scored by Kentucky in the last 15 seconds.
By Kentucky, by Jack Gibbons.
That's
he
right.
is Mr. Kentucky. He has 21 points to match his number in this first half. You hear him chanting in the background, Goose, Goose, Goose. 3 seconds remaining. Gibbons with a 1-1.
And there was a case where you have the experienced Jack Gibbons against the freshman Gene Banks. Banks probably should have pulled up and take the jump.
They went for the last shot. Either go in 5 down or possibly 3 down. You're in a nice
right.
position. Now they're gambling. They might go in 7 down. But there's 3 seconds left. As we said many times, that means there's more than 3 seconds.
And now one thing that Duke has to be careful of is the fact that Kentucky may press right here and go right after him trying to get the inbound steal. They can't be careless.
I doubt whether they'll do that, Philly, because we're in the 1-1.
There you go. 23 points in this
half.
Oh,
what a pass.
Roby
and he'll throw it back the other way. Well, it's been given, it might have been.
Look at the Kentucky faithful as they stand and cheer their Wildcats and Jack Gibbons at the end.
Interesting, too, the way Joe Hall.
The top-rated Wildcats lead the Blue Devils 45-38. Kentucky seniors are playing in their 123rd game, and Jack Gibbons may be playing his best ever, his 23 points spurring the Wildcats into a 45-38 lead at halftime. And we'll return with Kirk Gowdy and Al McGuire in ProCAD's College Basketball Report following these messages from your local station.
Kirk Gowdy, Al McGuire here, a 7-point lead for Kentucky. We saw almost a perfect game here. Bill Walton, 44-point performance against Memphis State. Jack Gibbons is almost matching that tonight. 23-point, he has scored 18 of the last 20 points for Kentucky.
Well, they have to go to a combination now. When a man gets that hot, especially when he's a senior, he gets so much confidence that everything he throws up goes in. He did score the last 16 points in the half. I think what the game is still very, very tight. It's a 7-point spread. It's an important call at the end, Kurt. It's a 5-point spread. Duke had the ball. If they made the last shot, they're going 3 up. They called the charge on Banks, which I thought it was a charge. They made it a 7 points. And now it's going to be tough. Duke has to come out and get that first basket because Kentucky's now on the first plateau. Seven is the first plateau. 13 is the second. This changes your coaching philosophy. Then 17 to 18 point lead, the game should be over.
This is a young Duke team. I've never seen better free throw shooting. In the semifinals and the first half of this final game, they have made 52 of their last 56 free throws.
Well, that's the greatest part of their ball game. They're extremely well coached. They complement each other. They have to complement each other because they're so young. And I really hope they keep dreaming because they're going to make a couple of more strong runs at Kentucky, and maybe they'll be fortunate at the wire.
Could be an exciting second half. You've seen the excitement, the pageantry, new events of sport that match college basketball. And these finals each year, and we've observed them over the years, just seem to get wilder and wilder and wilder. Our cameras set out to capture all the emotions that are so much a part of this college game. And so we've come up with a feature that we call an ode to college basketball.
Thank you. Mexican display. I think you'll see even more than that in the second half of this game. Now we're going to continue with Pro Kids College Basketball Report in just a moment. 7-point lead for the favorite team, Kentucky. What do you look for in the second half?
Well, with Kentucky, they're going to come out and I believe go right into the 1-3-1 zone, make Duke shoot from far out in the perimeter because of their size, and only allow one shot because of the tree trunks they got underneath. Where Duke's going to have to come out here, be a little bit more aggressive with this zone, maybe have to go to man, but there's plenty of time left in anybody's ball game.
Well, that's the end of our Pro Kids College Basketball Report. We'll be back after this message from the NCAA.
It's Kentucky 45, Duke 38, and we'll return to the Checkerdome in St. Louis for the second half after these messages from your local station. The 1978 NCAA Basketball Championship game is being brought to you by Avis, the We Try Harder Car Rental Company. By the new Gillette Atra Razor, the Impossible Shave. By Pabst Blue Ribbon Beer, naturally brewed Pabst, a lot to look forward to. And by Lincoln Mercury, nobody has more kinds of cars for more kinds of people, including the new Mercury Zephyr Z7, born to challenge the competition. We're ready for the second half. Kentucky leads by 7 as we return to our studios for this message.
Can owners need tough tires. I'm Patrick Ross, president of the B.F. Goodrich Tire Division. For years, we've made a radial tire for demanding conditions called the TA, and it's the best performing radial we've ever made. Now we make that same performance-proven tire for passenger cars. It's called the Advantage, and it's everything we've ever learned about making radial tires at B.F. Goodrich. We're the other guys, and only we've got the Advantage.
Lincoln Mercury introduces two magnificent sevens, Cougar XR7, Zephyr Z7. Baby, put a charge in your life.
Cougar XR7, bold, elegantly styled, deeply padded, luxuriously equipped.
Baby, put a charge in your life.
Zephyr Z7, high voltage styling with a price that comes as a pleasant shock. Two magnificent sevens.
Baby, put a charge in your life.
Well, we won tonight, but it was quite a fight. Now it's all behind. Got blue ribbon on my mind.
I've got Pabst Blue Ribbon on my mind. More and more lately I find I've got a taste for living. I'm thinking cold blue ribbon. I've got Pabst Blue Ribbon on my mind.
Naturally good Pabst. A lot to look forward to.
Guilty.
Not guilty. 6 votes guilty, 6 votes not guilty.
Molly, Jim!
This could go on all day, bailiff!
Pass out the right guard deodorant.
Good.
We got stick or spray.
With right guard, stick or spray protects all day. They don't just cover up odor, they help stop odor before it starts. All day.
6 took stick. 6 took spray. It's unanimous!
Right guard deodorant. Don't get dressed without it.
The obvious, Kentucky from the floor outscoring Duke by 9 field goals, but Duke staying in the game with a 20 out of 21 free throws to trail by only 7. Turnovers, rebounds, nothing significant there. Individual scoring, good balance from the 3 men that have led Duke all the way. Gminski with 12, Banks and Spanarkel with 10. For Kentucky, the man of the hour thus far, senior Jack Givens, 23 points. He made 9 out of 12 from the floor and 5 of 6 free throws as we get ready for the second half. Kentucky in quest of its 5th NCAA title. Only UCLA with 10 has more.
Dick, I think it's very interesting how Kentucky was able to cut off the Duke fast break both against Villanova and then, of course, on Saturday in their great win over Notre Dame. Duke was able to run up and down the court almost at will. Kentucky's cut that off very well, and as Al pointed out, they'll probably go to the zone defense in the second half, forcing Duke to put it up from outside. First time somebody got the tap against Roby in the entire playoff.
Inside to Gminski, a tough shot, he can't hit it, and James Lee has the rebound. Phillips on the bench with 4 fouls for Kentucky. Lee playing with 3, Roby inside. Gets away, good block by Gminski, and it's controlled by Duke's Gene Banks.
to Spanarkel. He'll gun and rattle it in. Jim Spanarkel. He now has 12 points.
That was a gut shot right there, and James Lee did a good play cutting off the fast break, but Spanarkel took advantage of it by taking it down the court.
He's an unbelievably fluid ball player. That first basket there meant an awful lot to Duke. He knocked it down to 5 points.
Oh, and he missed the kill. Boy, does he have quick hands. And what a pass to Harrell. Harrell will go in and score. The basket's good, but the foul is on Harrell.
Interesting call right there, and a great pass by Jim Spanarkel. Makes the jump shot, then makes a steal, then makes a super pass. Harrell made the basket, but he did foul. Here we'll see it coming right up. Spanarkel really has the quick hands. Look at him. He leaned, put his hands in there, held up, made the great pass. Harrell goes in. Clater was there. Good call.
First foul on Harrell. Kentucky's 7-point lead at halftime is Harrell 2-3. 45-42. We play just a minute. There's big Jim Lee. He bounces it home, danced it on the front edge of the rim, and nestled it in for Kentucky.
Oh, that was a big pass.
Spanarkel again taking charge of the game.
Taking over.
Why don't you like to see a young kid say, hey, I want to win. Give me the ball. I think I can score for you. That I think. I know I can.
Interesting, too, the way Joe Hall is playing against the 2-3. Now he's put Lee down in low right in front of Gminski.
There's Gibbons. He misses, but Lee there. And it's tipped in by Gibbons. There's Gibbons. He's going to make Joe Hall smile, yes.
Let's play one-on-one. Spanarkel against Gibbons.
25 points for Gibbons. Gminski, not there. Tipped in by Kenny Denard, number 33 of Duke. He's first points of the game.
Now that's the first time Duke's been able to capitalize against the 1-3-1 by having good baseline rebounding themselves.
Well, they send him the second man in the baseline. Duke is surprisingly good. I thought this dream would end tonight, but it doesn't look like it's going to end.
Truman Plater hits a 20-footer for his fourth point of the game, and Kentucky leads 5-5. Boy, a fast-paced second half. 2 minutes gone. Inside to Banks, and he's fouled by Lee. That'll be four on James Lee, and he has replaced Mike Phillips, who also has four.
Critical foul for Kentucky because Lee was really playing a strong ball game in the low post.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a tough part of our business. Apparently, before the game tonight, there was a call to a TV station and here to the arena threatening the life of this player, Gene Banks. The police are aware of it. The security is very heavy. The coach knows, the coach of Duke. It's delicate reporting a live news event, but that's what we have, and it's unfortunate this becomes a part of tonight's story. Gene Banks does not know.
That's really a sick situation for a beautiful thing here like the NCAA Championship, where everything is really wholesome and healthy.
Banks looking for his 11th point. That was his first miss from the line. He made all eight in the first half and misses them both.
There again, Kenny Denard staying down court a little bit too late. They thought they had a walking violation.
And a technical foul on Bill Foster. You hate to see that in a championship game, don't you, Al?
That was a quick call. A lot of times when the coach gets hit with a technical, it means he's right because it's a subconscious defense by the official. There was not a word said then. What he did, he made a sign of a traveling violation. Now, I might agree that it might have been a traveling violation, but the technical was very, very fast. And that's all I can say about it.
How could Jim Bain, the official, so far from Foster with all this noise, hear anything?
Well, I said he made the sign of the walk by rotating his hands.
No, Foster nailed with a technical, and it cost him two shots by Macy, and that's like giving Kentucky 2 points, and they get the ball. They have their biggest lead of 7 points again.
Now, that type of technical is only a misdemeanor because you don't lose the ball, too. See?
If he had the ball, it would have been worse.
Then it would have been a felony.
That would have been then a possible 6-point play. Now it's only a possible 4-point play. So Kentucky has a chance to get its biggest lead. Oh. They have it. Rick Proby cuts away that lead as he slams it home.
Oh, that was a tough call to make in this game.
That's Kenny Denard. And it may be that young Duke will come unglued now. Denard off the bench. What a play by Denard.
Kenny Denard on that catch that time because it was a very tight pass.
12 points for Gene Banks.
They're still in the 2-3 zone out here. Really strapping hard. Actually, Denard's coming out too far in that 2-3. He's going to get himself caught. I think he's hurt.
Yes, he acts as if he's either tired or hurt. He's grimacing. He's giving a sign. Take me out. That's Denard, far left of your picture.
Hey, call a referee's timeout and get the kid out of there.
Well, he doesn't see it, and of course you can't. Kenny Denard would get his attention right now. He can't get his attention. He's going to have to gut it out.
The bench of Duke is trying to get the attention. There's Gibbons, and that was Denard's area. So Gibbons got an easy shot because Denard couldn't cover him. And Duke, he has a cramp apparently, and now timeout is called by the official. And oh, there's Foster and Bain. Bain is the man who called the technical on Foster. And Foster saying, hey, what's going on here? 16 minutes and 15 seconds remaining in the game. Kentucky leads by 9.
The new pension laws were driving me crazy, so I called the Connecticut General people. And did they come through for me?
Come in through for you. That's what CG people do.
We had some dental bills. Then my company got a Connecticut General group dental plan. CG sure came through for us.
Come in through for you. That's what CG people do.
Call us. We'll come through for you, too.
A poem about deodorants. Roll, roll, roll on, all sticky and wet. Or spray your underarm. What a fog you'll get. So give me the stick. Old Spice deodorant stick. It goes right to the spot. All wet or foggy, it's not. It guards against odor the whole day long. With Old Spice freshness, you cannot go wrong. So goodbye, roll-on. So long, spray. Old Spice stick. It's the only way.
Old Spice stick.
Duke with the ball. Trailing Kentucky, 57-48. Carroll off to Gminski. Spanarkel. Boy, Duke attacks that zone nicely. Spanarkel fouled. He had a piece of LaVon Williams as he followed in. Here's where Denard got hurt.
Seems to me that he must have twisted his ankle or something in there. There he goes. See what happens.
Billy, I think the knee, Roby's knee caught the inside of his knee here. See,
looks that
right?
Way. Let's
yeah,
see.
Right there.
Yeah, there he got him. He got it inside the knee. It looks like Kenny Denard's all right. He's over there walking around. I think he'll be back in the game shortly.
That's not a serious thing, but it's a painful thing.
He's been replaced by number 30, Jim Suttis, the freshman. Kentucky trying to build on its 9-point lead with 15 minutes and 40 seconds left.
I think there was a big technical foul in the Arkansas-Notre Dame game earlier tonight, which Arkansas won in dramatic style, and that turned things around for Arkansas. See how the teams react to it here in this one.
Kentucky taking a little air out of the ball, Al.
Yeah, I think that they're going to force Duke out of their zone.
Joe Hall standing across the way, orchestrating. As Slater misses the shot, he was fouled by Harrell, number 22 of Duke. There's the young freshman from Pine, North Carolina. Kenny Denard. What a relationship between Banks and Denard, two freshmen. That was one of the most beautiful pictures you'd ever want to see. Denard and Banks and that dance of one and then the other would lift the other. What it's all about, Coach.
Only in college sports.
Later, an excellent free throw shooter. And there it is. As they embrace, then Denard would pick up Banks and then Banks would lift him high in the air. A dance of victory. Later, it's one of two, and that's Kentucky's biggest lead, 58-48. Plenty of time left, 15 minutes, 15 seconds.
With Denard out of the ball game, and Gminski out of the ball game also, it's going to be up to Spanarkel now to really take things over.
That's Getch in the post, and someone reaching in gets the foul. It is Gibbons of Kentucky. He is so lightning quick, or maybe it's Macy. Maybe it's May. It is Kyle Macy. Not nope. Gibbons, but Macy.
Joe Hall didn't want to foul there. He wants to force Duke now to put it up from the outside, and by slowing down the tempo on the other end of the court, I think he's just teasing Bill Foster a little bit, Al, trying to see whether he will come out of the zone yet.
What he's doing here is a tighter zone, a 2-3 zone, rather than their famous 1-3-1.
Boy, the ball tipped by Macy and recovered by the ever-present Spanarkel. The high lob to Banks. And, oh, that goes to Kentucky as Gibbons went over the back to knock it out of bounds.
That lob pass has been there throughout the year, but Gibbons did a superlative job that time, being in the right place at the right time.
I wonder how he looted the foul, too. He really can jump.
Here, now Duke is bringing their zone out a little bit higher. A 1-3-1 half court. Probably going to trap out of this if they get a man in the corner.
Kentucky leads by 10. Number one almost the entire year. Arkansas 1 week in the polls, number one. Marquette 1 week. But other than that, from opening bell, it's been these Wildcats. Oh. Jack Gibbons has 29 points. Three consecutive years. He made the coaches all Southeastern Conference team. And the Wildcats spell another title. 14-21 left. Kentucky by 12.
It's really nice to get to know ya, have a coffee show ya, round for just a while. Coca-Cola's life, and everybody wants it.
Many Cadillac owners are switching to Lincoln Continental. How do they like their new cars?
For luxurious space, Lincoln beats Cadillac hands down.
I want a luxury car that looks like a luxury car. Lincoln Continental does.
The EPA rates the mileage virtually the same for the two cars, so why should I drive the smaller one?
In 1977, sales of all Cadillacs were up 10%, but sales of Lincoln Continental, Mark V, and Lincoln Versailles were up 48%. They're a standard by which luxury cars are judged.
As the NCAA begins its 73rd year, concerned with its responsible role in emphasizing the importance of intercollegiate athletics in our society, it looks forward to continuing its part in the vibrant heritage of America. Highest priority goes to the service it provides to over 800 voluntary members, acting as the true voice of college athletics. Preceding message furnished by the NCAA. This is Dick Enberg at the Checker Dome in St. Louis, Missouri. Al McGuire, Billy Packer, Kurt Gowdy with me. It's 60-48. Kentucky leading young Duke with 14 minutes remaining in the game. Kentucky has led most of the way. Gminski back in the game.
Oh,
jump
what
hook.
A tough shot.
Jump hooked by the sophomore Gminski. He has 14 points.
What made that so tough? You can see the Kentucky's bringing their zone back into the top of the key now, and it's going to make it really tough to get shots on the inside as he just did there. Duke's coming out farther.
That's Slater.
Oh, what a block.
But it's going to be goaltending. Goaltending against Gminski.
Great drive. Duke. Great drive by Slater. Really playing a positive game out there. The ball goes up. Oh, pretty close to the peak right there.
62-50 as Slater gets the basket. And pressure is on the Duke Blue Devils. Here's a steal by LaVon Williams. He could have gone with it. Elected not to dribble.
Nice play.
Well, is this the second plateau, Coach?
Yeah, they're at a breakout point right now. If they score here now, it's going to be a different ball game. It'll be very tough for Duke to get back into it.
It's man-to-man, and Kentucky really taking advantage of it.
Roby, he has such big strides. He went from one side of the basket to the other to score. He has 14, and Kentucky starts to pour it on.
Duke will not be able to play a man-to-man. They're going to be a little bit tired to start off with, and Kentucky too quick and big for him.
Gminski can't hit. Gminski gets the rebound, and the foul is on number 52, LaVon Williams of Kentucky. Watch Roby. Look at the big stride on this racehorse from Kentucky.
Well, he made a good pump fake and went all the way across the lane, laid it up beautifully, and he's a tower strength. 16 points. What he does so well, he guards the center sometimes, strong forward other times. Really been a good man on the break.
Plus, he covers the 94 feet of the court. Very few centers can cover the way he does. Does a nice backdoor play there.
Jack Gibbons gets the rebound, and with a score of 64-50, and time ticking away, 13 minutes left.
Man to man, this could be tough for Duke right here.
Gibbons can't hit, but Roby right there to get. No, he misses the shot. Gibbons gets it. He scores, and he is fouled. Jack Gibbons, 31 points, and the Wildcat baseball are up and screaming again.
Incredible power play in hot inside. Gibbons having the game of his life. Puts it back up on Gminski. Gminski has to foul him. We're seeing the best of Kentucky right now.
A break in the action. 62-50. Kentucky trying to win their fifth title. We return to our studios for this message.
Lifting all that weight makes me feel just great. Now's the time I find, got Blue Ribbon on my mind.
I've got Pabst Blue Ribbon on my mind. More and more lately I find
good Pabst. A lot to look forward to.
Mr. Heidblum.
Huh?
Mr. Heidblum.
Yes?
Yeah, look, we understand that you're taking a trip with us tomorrow.
Trip?
Yeah, well, we want you to know that Avis is working right now.
Avis?
It's vacuuming your car, checking the oil, brakes, even the air in the spare tire.
Spare tire.
One of the ways Avis tries harder is working at night, so you're ready in the morning. Yeah. Oh, by the way, it's a Chrysler Cordoba, and it's blue. See you in the morning.
See you in the morning.
We try harder, Avis. Avis, we don't know another way.
NBC Sports covers the Greater Greensboro Open next weekend on Saturday, 3:30 Eastern Time. And big money at stake, $240,000. And that'll be followed as you get a golf doubleheader each day by the Colgate Dinosaur Open. That's a very rich purse for the ladies, $305,000 at stake. And Arnold Palmer will be driving into one of those par threes. And if he hits a hole-in-one, it's $1 million to someone. Tonight's attendance, 18,721. And many of them are from Kentucky. And are they in a love affair with this man, as they have been for 4 years? Goose Gibbons.
Stick with that man-to-man defense that Duke is forced to play now. They had to go to it, because even though there was 14 minutes to go, had to come to try to make their move on Kentucky. Kentucky really has taken advantage of it.
Bob Bender in the game with the ball for Duke. Spanarkel, tough defense. He scores. He's fouled by Cowan of Kentucky.
The last timeout, Bill Foster says to his club, hey, with 16 points down, we might be 17 down. There's a lifetime left. There's 12 and a half minutes left. Let's cut it down to about 6 or 8 points with about 6 minutes to go, and then we'll make our final run. They had two very, very tough breaks just before the half on the charging foul and the technical foul in the second half. Kentucky was leading 51-46. After the technical foul, they were up 9 points instead of five.
Spanarkel converts the three-point play. He has 16 points in the game, and it's a 66-53 Kentucky lead as Duke goes into some pressure in the backcourt. Kyle Macy is out for Kentucky. Jay Scheidler, the sophomore, is in.
Pass by Gibbons that time.
Blocked by Banks, recovered by Clater. That's Cowan. Rebound, Banks. Boy, is he strong. Remember, he's only a
long pass.
Gminski deals it nicely. Spanarkel inside, way off the mark.
Oh, he might have been passing. He did. I think he passed that ball. It'll go as an attempt, but I believe just out of just classy ball player made the pass.
So Spanarkel has made 5 points, two on a pass and on a three-point play, but Roby comes right back to score his 16th for Kentucky. Bender, Denard. And Kenny Denard hits. Oh, I tell you, these young Blue Devils don't know the word quit, do they?
Imagine to see which team tires out in this run quicker, though, Al. Somebody's going to have to substitute because it's really a furious face.
Gibbons pass. And a great play by Bender to save a sure 2 points as Roby was alone. Bender, if Duke would have won tonight or does win, would become the first player to ever be on two championship teams, two different schools.
Smart play by Gminski to hold his ground. Bender picked up the next man after the pass, came up with a big block.
Off Gibbons, out of bounds to Duke. So the Blue Devils, down by 16, have cut that deficit to 11 and can get under that double-digit mark, Al, and you feel that's important.
It's a psychological thing. I think we should tell the fans that Bob Bender played on the Indiana team 2 years ago in the NCAA.
Denard inside to Banks. Powers his way, can't hit, but a foul is called on home. Look at Banks and Denard. They appreciate each other. I love that friendship.
How would you like to have to coach against those guys for the next couple of years, Al, knowing they're going to be bookends there at the forward position?
Oh, they're just outstanding, but the emotion they have is what makes them.
That's the first foul on Roby. Gene Banks. Boy, was he highly recruited. Notre Dame thought they might get him. Pennsylvania. He elected to go to Duke. It's down to 10, 68-58. Plenty of time, 11 minutes, 20 seconds. So they're under the 10-point deficit. 9-point Kentucky lead, so Duke in 2 minutes has whittled 7 points away from the Wildcat advantage.
Interesting that press became more active and it's opening things up for Kentucky when they go down the court.
There it is, tipped in on a 3-1 break by LaVon Williams, and it's 70-59 Kentucky.
LaVon Williams has his own sewing machine. He makes his own clothes.
There's a foul reaching in. And before he goes to the line, let's go back to the tip by Williams.
Well, here's what's happening. The press is becoming more active. Things are opening up, though, for Kentucky when they bring it 3-on-1. Williams and Roby both in position to make that tap. So Duke has to take the gamble, Al. They've got to go ahead and press. When they do, if it's ever beaten, it's going to go all the way.
If anyone ever doubted the importance of Kyle Macy, we've just seen it. He was out for a couple of minutes, and Kentucky was not the same team.
He's the glue that holds them together.
He's back in there now. Spanarkel from 20, right down the bottom of the well. What a clutch performer, junior Jim Spanarkel. Duke has the top 8 players coming back next year. Only one senior, that's Bruce Bell, and he plays rarely. 19 for Spanarkel, a 9-point Kentucky lead, 10.5 minutes left.
Gene Banks had a good luck charm when they asked Denard if he had a good luck charm. He said, yes, it's Gene Banks. I agree with him.
Kenny Denard picks his fellowship carefully and wisely. He has 6 and made a good defensive play to save what appeared to be a sure hoop.
They go in zone out of bounds, and now that they've whittled the lead down, they're staying in the zone a little bit. That man-to-man was a disaster, but Phil Foster had to make a move.
We introduce the players for you. A guard for Kentucky, number 4, Macy, 25, Scheidler. LeVon Williams, Jack Gibbons at the forwards, Rick Roby at center. Spanarkel, Bender, Denard, Banks, and Gminski, the starting 5 with exception of Bender, in there for Duke.
Yeah, Macy pulled everybody back out and said, let's get organized. We've got the lead and the ball. Force Duke to play a little bit. Duke's going man to man.
We're under the 10-minute mark. 10 minutes left, 70-61, Kentucky. Out of bounds on the kick by Bender, and Kentucky will play it from the side.
Billy, they just have to come out because they're behind with the 5 count.
Right, what they're doing too, Al, is they're trying to match up a little bit out of it so that they do have some kind of pressure man to man. Watch both Bender and Kenny Denard. They're still in the zone.
Scheidler, not there, but there's Gibbons. The omnipresent Jack Gibbons has another rebound. And there he is, the Goose.
Oh, he's having a night, isn't he? Career.
33 points for Gibbons, stolen by Macy. And Kentucky with an 11-point lead, riding on the shoulders of Jack Gibbons. There he is.
Now Duke is trying to compensate so much for Gibbons. They're not covering everybody else.
Look at him go for the ball, and a whistle traveling against Kentucky.
You know, Dick, people seem to think that Kentucky's blowing them out. Hey, it's an 11-point game. We got over 9 minutes. Anybody's ball game. Big basket coming up.
Bill Foster trying to tell his team be patient as well. I think that's an important point, Al McGuire, and the fans, reporters, dissing off of them, coaches. No, the patience of the game. You can't hurry.
Coach Wooden, it's always said, don't hurry, but be quick.
Inside the bank, blocked, rejected by Roby. And here come the Wildcats. He blocked. And look at Spanarkel. He was there anyway.
Amazing play by Spanarkel. He faked out to try to block the pass and pulled back in. And looks like James Lee coming back in there with the 4 fouls on him.
LeVon Williams goes out. He makes a young mistake. And returning to the lineup for Kentucky, Big James Lee, number 32. He's playing with 4 fouls.
Still in the zone in Kentucky.
And here's a slap that time. Denard inside to Banks. He's open. Good setup by Kenny Denard, the two friends, Denard to Banks.
Basketball at its best right there.
8:40 left, 16 for Banks.
But Joe Hall wants his team to get into some kind of offense. Right now, a little bit confused. Nobody really going to the basket.
Why, look at that Spanarkel. He must have 8-foot long arms the way Plastic Man's on defense. He's got to be a little tired also. What's the call? Kicking against Duke. It'll go to Kentucky.
I believe that Kentucky needs a timeout to get their head straight together. They seem to have indecision. And an athlete with indecision is a no-no.
You're right, Al. What's happening to them? They don't know whether to hold the ball, let the clock go by, or go somewhere on offense. I think Joe Hall realizes they need some more points. They got to keep playing this game.
It's too early to go against the clock. You know what? Can I explain something here? I'll try to quickly. What you start with now is what they call milking. You try to move it to the next minute. That makes it the 8 to the 7. Then you play your regular game. As you get it down around 4 or 5 minutes, then you go to delay. A delay is when you take a 95% shot of making it. Then you go to your freeze. When you make your freeze move with a minute or two to go, that means you take no shots under any conditions if you're all alone.
That's a strategy.
All right, you go from milking to delay to freeze. Three different offensive moves to take the clock away, to kill the clock. There's Gibbons.
Good pass.
Nicely by Banks.
He came a long way to deflect that, and you heard Groby in the background, I'm sure, say, hey, Jack, because he had the open cut, but Banks' great quickness was able to slap the ball away.
Hey, Billy, do you know what I just explained?
Yeah, I got you. The only thing is, that was your technique. Dean Smith and some others use others, but that, I think it's very good philosophy, yeah.
Spanarkel had his hands in the ball again. We are seeing some brilliant athletes on display tonight. Hall and Foster matching their wits. And it's Kentucky in the lead by 9, 72-63, less than 8 minutes left.
Well, Spanarkel just working himself to a frazzle. He's going to be tired when this one's over.
Roby comes high.
How many times has Roby come out to be the outlet pass?
Not
a good shot there.
Oh! What a follow by Rick Roby. He's one of the candidates for the Wooden Award for the outstanding player in the country. That'll be announced next Sunday.
Got a piece of that one.
Gminski. Rebound Sutter, it'll count, and he's fouled by Scheidler.
Did my man Harry catch that one?
Excellent play on the inside that time by Sutter. He was battling his own people for it. There you see, Scheidler, that really is not milking it, Al. That's a 30-foot shot there, but look at Roby from the top of the key, came all the way down. Great play.
Give Harry Coyle a raise on that one.
Harry Coyle, George Finkel, our director and our producer, executive producer Don Olmeyer, our great camera crew, 10 of them lit up and firing away. It's another major league effort by NBC Sports, and to the credit of this great game, we hope you're enjoying it.
What I liked about Roby so much in that last play, Dick, is the fact that he was the outlet pass, 25 feet from the basket, then he ends up making the tap right under the hook. Here's that press again.
Gibbons helping out. It's down to 9, and Sutter thought he made the three-point play, could have whittled another.
They need to break a guy to the high post. There he is.
James Lee to Gibbons. Scores his body so beautifully. Gibbons has a 35-point game. The NCAA final record, Bill Walton with 44.
Joe Hall does an excellent job of coaching.
Sutter not there. Lee, a power rebound for Kentucky. With 6:45 left, the Wildcats have an 11-point lead, and the Pumpkin, and time has been called.
Good time. Good call of the timeout. Get reorganized.
Well, I think that Duke is tired at the present time. They're starting to get a little fear. And the hardest thing in coaching is to stop fearing your ball players. There's no armament against fear.
You saw Duke play several times earlier this year, Billy Packer. Are you surprised they got this far?
No, I'm not surprised, to be quite honest. I think the Eastern Regional was one of the easiest trips to the Final Four. You know, on our show originally, before it all started, we talked about that. I think that they're a young club. They matured well during the course of the year. And Al, one of the big things you've always talked about bringing a team along is scheduling. Bill Foster took a chapter out of your book. He said, well, I scheduled some people that were easy to beat. And I knew I had a hard season, and I needed these guys to get some confidence.
He matured his team as it came along, and they peaked at NCAA time.
Not allow a second shot down here. We're just close to stealing the basketball, and we're not getting the second shot.
Dropping on Bill Foster. Now let's isolate on the star of the game, Kentucky's Jack Gibbons.
This was a great pass. We don't see the pass, but Lee, but he knew exactly where to go. Jack Gibbons used his body to shield Banks away, made a super play in there. There was the experience, Al. When the Kentucky team felt the middle open, Lee just broke to the middle. Gibbons and Roby went ahead and flared on the side and just moved with the ball. Just a super play.
Flash into the middle, took the pressure off the baseline. Gibbons snuck in behind him. Then he made a simple layup before a fella tried to dunk in that situation. And that's stupid, because you get an automatic 2 points without dunking.
And that timeout, let's see if they're going to go to a little delay game. Be kind of interesting. They're going to try to bring Duke out, make him go man-to-man. But Duke still is somewhat in that zone. They're just matching up right now.
Joe Hall has replaced Rick Roby with Mike Phillips. He's playing in the center position.
This is their freeze, and now they're going to go and play. They wanted to see what Duke would do.
Gibbons, a rare miss. Rebound Banks. Big guy can handle it. Spanarkel.
Yo, oh, wow.
Pass. Love to see the great pass. most exciting play in basketball, the well-executed pass for the easy shot.
He reminded me of my brother Dick Denny. My brother was really a great passer with St. John's and New York Knickerbockers. Passing is a lost art.
What was interesting about that timeout, it helped Joe Hall get his team organized, and it also, right when Duke was starting to get exhausted, helped them get a slight rest there.
You see the clock under the six-minute mark. Kentucky by nine. Phillips hits a baseline eight-footer. Mike Phillips of Kentucky, 4 points. Oh, a good Kentucky team, and they've proved it all season long. And they have 5.5 minutes to kill to clinch another NCAA title. Banks can't hit. Scheidler rebound. Oops, traveled. That's going to be a double dribble. Jay Scheidler as Banks hits the wood.
Banks is the guy that got the rebound on this play right here. Dishes it out very well. Going to get the ball back, but he keeps hustling. For the young players in the game, move without that ball, keep hustling. You get it back from a teammate unselfishly, as Spanarkel did right there.
You know, the last play, Billy, where Banks missed that layup on the alley-oop pass, the pass was too low. Anytime you see someone scoring an alley-oop pass, the pass is the key, not the scoring in the basket.
Roy Givens and Roby and Macy and Lee, they're going to be on the USA team. And there's Macy with a near steal, but Banks gets it and scores it. David Greenwood, Bird, Griffith, Urban Johnson, Moncrief. Joe Hall will be the coach. That'll be 2 weeks from yesterday. Sports World from Lexington, Kentucky, from the Rupp Arena.
A lot of time, Al. They really went into a delay game. Once again, there's a little bit of uncertainty there. You talked about the milking. They still got to go for the score. There's one. Oh, that's a good block.
Oh, they called it goaltending. Goaltending.
Can't see that one. Bill Foster can't see that one either.
That one hurt.
What do you think?
There you go, right there. The ball on the way up. He gets a piece before it ever came close to hitting the backboard. Looked like a good block to me.
Touching the backboard doesn't make any difference, Billy.
Oh, no!
Denard thought he was fouled. You heard him say, oh, no. Oh,
smart play by Spanarkel trying to draw the charge. Not there. Mike Phillips was all alone.
Time running out on Duke.
Oh, Gibbons. What a play!
Jack Gibbons almost bounced the ball off an opponent's shoulder. Stayed up there and scored. And there's Gibbons again. And a foul is on Gibbons, who has 37 points. He's only 7 points away from Bill Walton's NCAA final game record. And what a performance. His all-time high for Gibbons, the second man in Kentucky history, joins Dan Issel over the 2,000-point mark. Only five in the SEC in that history of that great conference have scored as many as 2,000 points. And Gibbons punctuating his career, trying to win his team a championship in his finale.
You know, Dick, it was really interesting. Before the game, I saw Jack, and I said, you know, good luck. And he was very serious, and the tone of his game was that way. On the other side was Duke University. Kenny Denard came over to me, and he said, hey, Billy, can you get me one of those white NBC jackets? I couldn't believe it.
Why don't you give him one of the tenants you took out of the hospitality room? Bro?
I sold the nine. I only got one left on my kids.
Spanarkel at the line for the Blue Devils of Duke University. He'll be back next year. So will all of the players you've seen tonight playing for Duke. 20 points now for Spanarkel. Been a great tournament. It's had everything. The underdogs winning. Miami, Western Kentucky, an incredible performance by unknown Cal State Fullerton. Duke certainly coming out of the shadows of North Carolina. The Tar Heels getting most of the publicity this year, and Duke into the tournament. And then there's the consistency of the Thoroughbreds from Kentucky. They've been good all year, and they're trying to cross that finish line with a win that they want ever so much. And no one can quite appreciate all the pressure on a team so good.
Well, full court man to man now. They're trying to go ahead and match up. Look at Gibbons trying to find an open hole.
Kyle Macy, Cooley nails a 20-footer, and Kentucky leads by 13.
Oh, holy mackerel.
A man can't jump that high, can he?
He went so high that he got burnt on re-entry.
4 minutes left, and the amazing young Blue Devils giving Kentucky a great game, but they haven't stopped this man. Goose, go!
Oh, that hit the side of the backboard.
That isn't what he intended to do. You can't cut him that thin.
Goose, 39. I give up. I give up, Goose. Stop.
39 for Gibbons. Spanarkel. Gminski. Banks.
they're really battling. This is a super effort on the part of both teams.
Spanarkel hanging, dumping. Banks tip to Gminski.
He's a little tired, but he still hits.
86-75, but time runs on. 3:15 left.
This time, Duke has to make his last charge, and it's coming up right now. 3:11.
He's trying to get Bender and Denard.
Here it comes.
2-on-1, set it with Spanarkel. Right away. The freshman got out of control. That's a possible four-pointer, Al.
Exactly. What happened now, you're getting some guys that have just gone to exhaustion. They don't have anything left to execute with.
Gminski really seems tired. Gibbons has two more. He has 41 points. He needs three to tie the all-time record. Jack Gibbons with an incredible performance.
Somebody needs to throw out a white towel.
I wonder who's going to get the most valuable in this game.
Let's do that now. That's a piece of business. Oh, all right. First, we better pay for it. We're going to give away $5,000 to Kentucky. We'll keep you in suspense and tell you who that might be. We'll win our award. We'll be right back.
Put a charge in your life.
There's a new personal car in town. Zephyr Z7 from Lincoln Mercury.
Baby, put a charge in your life.
Sexy styling, buckets with a price that's a very pleasant shock. Z7 runs with a four-door Zephyr wagon, rated 4 cubic feet more cargo space than Aspen or Volare. And Z7 equals the best mileage rating in its class.
Zephyr!
I'm a stockbroker, but I just talked one of my best clients out of the stock market. It's not that I don't have faith in the market. I have other clients in it heavier than ever. To me, the difference between winning and losing for my clients is handling each one as an individual. Bache gives us 65 investment alternatives to create a program for any client. Bache can help me to be a winner, and that's precisely why I work here.
The winning attitude at Bache. Put it to work for you.
There's the trophy that goes to the outstanding player in this championship game. It goes to Jack Gibbons School, Kentucky. Kentucky will get the trophy, earned from the Gillette Most Valuable Player Award. It goes to number 21, Jack Gibbons. A trophy in Gibbons' name will be given to his school. In addition, a check from Gillette for $5,000 will be sent in Jack Gibbons' name to the General Scholarship Fund of the University of Kentucky. He has scored on 18 field goals and 5 free throws tonight. Oh, there he is. Oh, almost a steal. I wonder if he knows he's only 3 away from Bill Walton.
I don't think that that's something that really bothers him. The way he's playing, as intense as he is in his ball game, it's just going to come if it comes.
Spanarkel can't hit. Denard can't rebound. Bender fires it up and scores. Bob Bender, 6'2", muscling his way in to get two and a chance at a three-point play. And now it's back to 11.
Are they tough kids? Do they get big motors? That means hard. And they're hanging in here. They're just unbelievable. This game is not over. I'm telling you, if they make their last charge here, it's over 2 minutes. I've seen things happen like this before. Maybe we'll have to take back the most valuable player.
The hand is for Mike Phillips, who has just fouled out, congratulated by his teammates, Coach Joe Hall. Phillips leaves with 4 points, did not have a big scoring game, but remember, this man got Kentucky to the finals. He led them in scoring in the first 3 games of the tournament.
Made those big, big free throws in the Mideast Regional. Here goes the full court press again. What Kentucky doesn't realize is that Duke is sending all 5 guys to the boards to rebound. They could easily break a man long for a long pass and a layup.
A foul will be called on Bender of Duke, trying to stop the charge of Kentucky. 88-78 the game score with more than 2 minutes left, and Kentucky visits that 15-foot stripe. They stop the clock.
Well, Truman Clater has to make this foul shot. What happens in foul shooting in tight situations, if one guy misses, then the next misses, and it's like the measles. Everyone starts catching it.
Wait a minute. What do we see right here? They're not in a free throw situation. Only 5 fouls on Duke. They're not in 1-1 yet.
Oh, excuse me.
Roby back in, and Bender with a try for the steal.
And not being in 1-1, they can go for some steals now, pick up a foul.
Kentucky with a 10-point lead as Lee goes in.
He lost the handle on the way in.
Rebound Denard of Duke University. Denard Hoffman, our statistician tonight.
Oh, what a catch.
Gminski can't hit the follow-up. Oh, that was a possible 3-point play. Look at Mike Gminski.
said, what am I doing? He said, I couldn't miss two of those if you gave me $1,000.
You know, it's incredible when you look at those fellows on the floor. All of those players from Duke will be back, and every guy sitting on the bench will be back next year, except for one fellow.
Gminski shooting two. It's down to nine, 88-79.
There's a case when we talk about, particularly Al, with only five fouls on Duke right now, they can use that clock very well now the rest of the way.
They also should have a sub over there, getting in every time the ball goes dead, which stops the clock. I thought that James Lee shouldn't have taken that last shot.
That's right, he lost the handle.
That under 2 minutes, you should go after the clock, not the opponent.
Gminski has been perfect from the line, and the pressure on.
There's the man breaking long. Good catch by Roby.
Roby needed those long limbs to save that one. Duke trying to steal the ball.
They can go ahead and foul. I'm trying to make a big steal here.
Following tonight's game, stay tuned for your local news, followed by The Tonight Show, starring Johnny Carson, then tomorrow with Tom Snyder. Foul is on Spanarkel of Duke. And we want to thank, while we have a moment, Walter Byers, the executive director of the NCAA, Tom Jernstedt is assistant executive, David Kaywood, director of public relations for the National Collegiate Athletic Association, and our NBC crews around the country, New York, Los Angeles, Chicago. We pulled in all the forces, the army here, to cover this one. A minute and a half left. 88-80 the score.
The next one will be one-and-one situation. They've got six. I was surprised they didn't press man-to-man. That'll be one-and-one. Clater on the line.
Denard gets the foul. We pause briefly for station identification. This is the NBC Television Network. One and one for Kentucky. Denard has his third foul. Bill Foster looking for some steals. He trails by eight. And in from the sidelines will come Jay Scheidler. No, he will replace Clater, and Clater at the line.
You know, Al, even though Clater and Scheidler are not going to have big statistical games, in the beginning of the game, when Duke was in that zone, they hit some real key jumpers, and I think that really took away what Duke has been able to get by with in earlier games.
Well, Duke had a gamble either on the baseline or the outside. They gambled on the outside, but they're two excellent shooters. They'll come up with key baskets. They've been around a long time, even though they're both only juniors this year.
So Clater misses the free throw, but in the scramble for the rebound, Gminski fouls. Denard goes, that looked as if he was going out, stays in. To the sideline goes Clater. Jay Scheidler has replaced him in the backcourt for Kentucky, and Roby visits the line.
Roby and Givens, the two fellas we featured at the top of the show, Dick, they sure are quality kids and great athletes, and they've, during their career at Kentucky, you'd have to say that's a memorable period of time, and now we've got to think a name for this Kentucky ball club. They always have a special name.
Time running out of Duke. They trail by 11 now. Three free throws hit by the Wildcats. Inside, Denard to score easily. Kentucky's not going to foul. Quick timeout called by Spanarkel to stop the clock with a minute and 11 seconds left. There's an interesting story on Roby. He works at Claiborne Farms, and that is, of course, one of the many outstanding thoroughbred farms in Kentucky. And every day when he's working there, he feeds the big horse, Secretariat. And in many ways, this Kentucky team, and borrowing some of your phraseology, Al McGuire, if they win, they're the Secretariat of College Basketball.
I would more to say that they're the Seattle SLU of basketball. He has a great game today. I think we'll see both Givens and Roby for the next 10 years in the Pro League.
A minute and 11 seconds left. 91-82.
Dick, you know, something that comes up every year in the NCAA championships is the fact they ought to do away with the consolation game because the kids don't care. But I think tonight we saw in that first game how much it means to players of championship caliber. I think our hats should be taken off to that Notre Dame club in Arkansas. They put on a super, super show in that first game.
Arkansas winning on a Brewer shot at the buzzer by 271-69. I agree, Billy.
That is not called a consolation game. That game is called for the third place in the national championship, and I don't agree that game should ever be stopped. Number three in the nation is a very important thing. There's four teams that got here. They never have to drop their heads. Duke tonight can go out and have their ice cream sodas or their pizzas or whatever they wish to have, and they can be very, very proud of themselves.
Have to be.
And four of those Kentucky kids and Coach Shohaw will have a curtain call. They'll take a bow again a week from next Sunday in Lexington as the USA All-Stars play the Soviet team. Time running out.
We'll watch the clock for you. A near steal by the hustling Bender of Duke. Here's the official total on Jack Gibbons, 18 for 26 from the floor, 5 for 7 from the line. Number 21, Gibbons, with 41 points in the game. He still has a chance to break Bill Walton's NCAA record in the championship game.
That's a good pass. Let's see if he puts it up.
Oh. He doesn't hit that one, and the rebound by Denard.
Oh,
Spanarkel, Gminski. Nice pass to Denard.
Oh, yes. What a
pretty play. 91-84. Duke refuses to wilt. And this team is going to be back next year. And it's hustle, and it's talent, and it's fine coaching. Al McGuire portends another great year.
I'm upset about that last shot. I don't care about records or no records. The idea is to win the game and go home. I don't think the fella took the shot for the record, but I guess that the way 47 seconds to me is, again, another lifetime. I'm repeating myself. There's only a 7-point spread. I just don't believe the game's over yet.
What you're saying like, is forget the record, let's let the clock go by, win the game, go home, and we'll say I just missed the record by 3. Huh?
See, the only person that knows it is like the fellow that fights the bull, the coach. He's the only one. He's on the floor there. You know, he has soot on his face. He hears the bugles and smells the smoke of the war.
Now that I war. Don't understand what he's talking about.
Well, he's a
about.
War horse. It's not over.
There's one of the young Kentucky Wildcat cheerleaders. I don't know whether that's emotion or whether she suffered a fall.
I think so, Dick. I think two Kentucky cheerleaders got hit in the head because they both are holding ice packs. They either fell at one of their routines, but they don't want to leave this arena.
This is the 40th NCAA championship. 30 years ago, the Fabulous Five, 1948, Kentucky's first championship. And the names then were Ralph Beard and Alex Gross and Cliff Barker, Ken Rollins and Wawa Jones. And I remember, that's about the first college team that I remember, Al. And Kentucky won it then. They won again in 49 the next year, 51 and 58. And you see the total standings. And the Wildcats are 47 seconds away from their fifth championship, and you know how important just one is.
Well, the last two times they got to the finals, they lost. They lost to UCLA and to Coach Wooden, who's a legend. And the other game they lost was to the University of Texas of El Paso, which was a great ball game. That was played in Maryland.
You know what's interesting about that final, too, is that Kentucky and Duke in the semifinal that year up in Maryland really blasted themselves to exhaustion. And of course, Texas El Paso had that great club, well-coached, great defensive club.
Gibbons misses the free throw. Oh, two Duke players were there. Gminski and Denard. Spanarkel making the blind pass. That could have cut the lead down to 5 points. Gibbons has had a field goal attempt and a 1-1. Hasn't been able to make it. Denard needs a saddle for that one as he picks up the foul. 35 seconds left.
Watch Macy on the foul line now. He's an excellent foul shooter. Young people out there. The first thing he'll do is take a deep breath to relax himself. Then he'll dry his hands on his socks. First, he'll dry the inside, which he's doing now. Now he'll go back down and then dry the outside of his hands in a moment. He goes through a set ritual every time before he shoots a foul shot.
I think he always takes just 3 dribbles, too, Al. Watch, he'll do that, and he'll take 3 bounces before he shoots. There goes Rick Roby. Roby has been replaced in a standing ovation from many of the fans here in St. Louis. He leaves with 20 points. Macy connects. 92-84.
You know who's the next man coming out? There was the little ritual you saw, and it really helps to be a great free throw shooter too, regardless of the ritual.
This is Gminski rebounds. Bender ahead. Denard. Trying to get inside, and the foul is on Denard. No basket. Charging on Denard. And the basket is not allowed, and I believe that's his fifth foul of the game.
Now we're going to hear a real hand because I think it's time for Goose Gibbons to start coming out there. No, the next one's going to be Macy coming out. They'll bring the house down in the Goose, please.
Macy goes out. Denard, that was not his fifth foul. Macy, cool, only a sophomore. He was just the glue that Kentucky needed for those 4 brilliant seniors. And now I believe they're trying to get the attention of the officials that Denard has committed his fifth foul. Yes, he finally leaves, and a hand from the Duke crowd and the Kentucky crowd for Kenny Denard. And there goes Goose Gibbons. Gibbons leaves with 41 points. The star of the championship game.
Jack Gibbons is 41 points.
his heroes. And Kentucky finally, oh, how they've wanted this moment and how hard they've worked. And in defeat, one can only say, hey, there's time, young man. You've got three more years ahead.
And I'm anxious to see Joe Hall, and our camera work is right on the spot. I'm anxious to see when Joe Hall finally has a smile on his face. He's really worked hard.
Out goes James Lee, another senior, played his last game at Kentucky. Time clicking away. Steal by Bender, and he was fouled.
One thing you don't want to do in a ball game, Dwayne Casey fouling it. You want this clock to go and go and go.
Joe Hall said it's been tough. The only way we could have had a successful year is to win the NCAA. When we started practice, the small people close to our program began the year saying, we know you're going to win the NCAA, not we hope you'll win. It's a shame there isn't more of a feeling of accomplishment for what these young men have already done. And there's one of Bill Foster's four daughters. It's emotion packed. The winners and the losers are both crying.
It's extremely difficult for families. I always felt for my family. I was on the court. It was easy for me, but difficult for them.
Bob Bender hits two free throws, and Kentucky's lead is six.
Only 6 points.
And it's a near steal by Bender. Look at that.
23 seconds.
He had it for a moment. And maybe Joe Hall sets it 2-2 soon.
He's calling a timeout.
He's going to get Roby back in there.
Hey, remember that shot?
Oh, you don't fool with Mother Nature. Maybe I break out in heat rashes in tight ball games like this, but I still say there's time. If there's enough time to score three baskets, there's enough time to go into overtime. So I hope Joe didn't sub too soon.
Givens are going back in the ball game now, and I think not only the fact that they went out of the game, but they were replaced by guys who were already celebrating now. Now you got Lee going back into the ball game, so Kentucky put back the horses.
These cameramen have done such a great job with Mrs. Coyle and Finkel there in the truck. Let them show you the pictures. I think they speak for themselves.
And Rick Roby comes back, and he's really serious. He realizes that they have got themselves in a situation with plenty of time in his pocket. You can see the Duke team. They still feel they can pull us off.
See, the mistake what was made, if they could foul the Kentucky players, they were cold, they'd miss the foul shots. Where the starters are more confident, and they're older and more mature.
Jay Scheidler, he is fouled by Harrell. That stops the clock. Only a couple of seconds ticked away.
2 seconds.
Next year, we'll be at the Special Event Center of the University of Utah campus in Salt Lake City for the NCAA Championships. Oh, it's a classic event. As Kurt Gowdy said at the start of this telecast, it may be the toughest ticket in all of sport. I haven't seen him smile yet. I hope if Kentucky does win, that Joe Hall will show his ivory. I'd like to see him finally enjoy. It's been tough. He's taken a lot of criticism as a winning coach.
He's a great person. He's morally excellent, and he's a credit to basketball.
You know, and I think that movie made in the Florida State game has to go down as one of the all-time moves of guts by a coach.
They missed it.
Gminski gets the rebound. 18 seconds. Duke has to hurry. Gminski, tough shot.
Oh! Oh!
92-88 timeout with
10 seconds. It's not easy. It's not easy. Oh, incredible.
Imagine the war that's going inside of Joe Hall's stomach right now.
As if he said, I can't even do what most coaches usually can enjoy, and that's with only a few seconds left. Let my kids take a bow. I've got to put the starters back in. And this man, Bill Foster, matching him player for player.
You never play with a basketball game. You never appease the crowd. You never appease the authorities at school. All you try to do is win, get out of the place, and go have your pizza and beer.
Diagramming right down there. Now obviously timeouts are a factor, but they have to go again for the immediate steal, don't they, Al, and then try to get a foul situation. They can't get the steal. Don't even think that.
They're fouled intentionally, Billy, right off the bat.
Right.
If the refs fall too, then they'll put Kentucky in a favorable position.
Well, you know, a lot of times we talk about that intentional foul. If a guy is going for the ball, and that's the key thing, I think a player should go for that steal, as opposed to going wrapping his arms around somebody. He can come up with the one-on-one situation that way instead of the two.
Well, what happens now is
pass. And he needs two on one.
But it didn't call it.
A power dunk, and that's going to be it. The University of Kentucky are the basketball champions.
Difficult to follow a legend. They know all about that out of UCLA. And Joe Hall had to follow a legend at Kentucky. The winningest coach of all time, Adolph Rupp. 6 years now he's been there. And as he said, Kurt, you have to win every game all the time or they're not happy. So he's finally taken the big one back and stuffed the national championship trophy in the field house at Kentucky. They say in sports, never say never. Never again, I think now, from what we've observed, will there ever be another domination such as John Wooden had at UCLA, a winning 10 out of 12 and 7 in a row. In the last 5 years, the national title has now been spread to all parts of the country. North Carolina State in 74, UCLA in 75, Indiana out of the Big Ten in 76, Marquette in independent last year, and now from the Southeast Conference, Kentucky. Next year, it'll be Salt Lake. And the way the amazing young Duke team hustled tonight, they may be the favorite in Salt Lake next year. And a sixth different team will capture the national championship. And now, back to Dick Ember.
Kurt, nice job. And Al McGuire, Billy Packer, it's a tremendous climax to a season that I've enjoyed thoroughly, and I've enjoyed working with you gentlemen.
It's been a great run. I was with Kentucky throughout this playoff period, and they sure played some Super Bowl when they had to.
I enjoyed my relations with NBC, and I enjoyed working the NCAA tournament. It's been a ball.
Kentucky wins, Duke proudly in defeat, 94-88. For Messrs. Gowdy, Packer, and McGuire, this is Dick Enberg. So long from St. Louis, Missouri. This weekend, a great golf doubleheader. First at 3:30 Saturday, the Greater Greensboro Open, featuring top male professionals, playing for a purse of $240,000. Followed immediately by the Colgate Dinosaur Winner's Circle, where top female pros will be vying for prize money totaling over $300,000. Arnold Palmer will hit 21 shots on a par three. If one goes in, someone will win $1 million. That's this Saturday and Sunday here on NBC. Coming up next, your local news, followed in 1/2 hour by The Tonight Show, starring Johnny Carson. Then tomorrow with Tom Snyder. This has been a production of NBC Sports. Kentucky beats Duke, 94-88.
CIA spy, how he spied and why he stopped.
Coming up next, your local news, followed in 1/2 hour by The Tonight Show, starring Johnny Carson. Then tomorrow with Tom Snyder. This has been a production of NBC Sports. Kentucky beats Duke, 94-88.
CIA spy, how he spied and why he stopped. Spying for Uncle Sam, Tuesday night.
I love sugar, but not in a mint. I want my mint cool and refreshing. Now there's Velamints. They're new. They took the sugar out. You really taste the mint.
So fresh, they take your breath away.
New Velamints took the sugar out. You can really taste the mint. So fresh, they take your breath away. Cool refreshment, Velamint.
New sugar-free Velamints. You really taste the mint. Three refreshing flavors.
Make it good. Make it good. For a taste of morning sunshine. Morning sunshine.
Dodge pickup trucks like blue jeans, sure been round a lot. A lot of folks for a lot of years been glad for all they've got. Times have changed and styles have changed, but they did not stand still. They caught the spirit of today and they always will.
Dependable and versatile, beautiful machines. Dodge's into pickups like America's into jeans.
Smurf. Car ready?
Just about.
Good. Got to hit the road. Got to get out there and sell. Hey, Nick, did you hear the one about the...
What?
You're a girl. You hired a girl.
Sure, Jill was the best person qualified for the job. She's really got the spirit.
Say, ever hear the one about the traveling salesman who drove into Murph 76?
No.
He was a quart low on oil.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Go with the spirit of 76.
Earthquakes, Wednesday at 7:30, when havoc struck.
Oh, Major, this may sound crazy, but there's something strange going on with Caper One.
Lieutenant, sir, I think we should get out of here.
Monday Night Movie. A deadly bacteria from outer space threatens mankind. Arthur Hill and James Olsen star in Michael Crichton's The Andromeda Strain.
People are flying high without the aid of a plane. The Kentucky Wildcats played what could have been their best game of the season tonight, beating Duke 94-88. Jack Givens put on a tremendous one-man show, ending up with 41 points, and that's a career high for him. For Kentucky, it's the school's fifth national title. And for Coach Joe Hall, his first NCAA championship. NBC's Greg Gumbel has highlights of tonight's action.
Duke's young Blue Devil stayed with Kentucky early as Eugene Banks hit on the jumper from the side. And the Blue Devils cashed in heavily at the free throw line, collecting 20 out of 21 attempts. Duke's spark plug Jim Spanarkel forced the turnover, then took the lead pass and hit the jump shot as Duke closed to within one, 29-28. But Kentucky's Jack Givens, number 21 in white, went on a scoring spree, putting the last 14 Wildcat points on the board in the first half and 16 of their last 18 to push Kentucky into a 45-38 advantage at the break, as both crazies and coaches observed from the sidelines. In the second half, the Kentucky muscle came to light. Rick Roby on the flying stuff for two of his 20 points, but Givens was the man. His following shot after a Roby miss here added to his game-high total of 41 and pushed the Wildcat lead to 16. The Blue Devils never gave up, Gene Banks coming off the baseline for two, but it was Givens leading the Wildcats of Kentucky to the NCAA title 94-88 over Duke. Greg Gumbel, NBC News.
Some game, and one I'm sure Kentucky fans will never forget. And for some reason, I think Coach Joe Hall will not sleep tonight. We'll have more highlights and some afterthoughts on the season tomorrow night on our 5 o'clock news beat. In the consolation game tonight, Ron Brewer hit a 25-foot jumper at the buzzer to give 6th-ranked Arkansas a 71-69 victory over 11th-ranked Notre Dame in St. Louis. The Irish rallied from a 4-point deficit with 68 seconds left to tie the game on baskets by Kelly Trapuka and Tracy Jackson. Brewer then got the ball. He casually walked up court, stopped near the top of the key, and waited till the clock wound down to 1 second, and then he put the ball in the hoop. Gail Caplet, head basketball coach at the University of Cincinnati for the past 6 years, has resigned to become head coach at West Virginia University, his alma mater. A source close.
WKYT-TV, Channel 27, Lexington.
Coal contracts seemingly going down to defeat. Details on Newsletter 27 at 11.
Lexington, Kentucky, in the heart of the bluegrass country. This is a country famous for its thoroughbred horses and its championship basketball teams. This is Kentucky Countdown, the story of the 1978 Kentucky Wildcats basketball team. The countdown, according to Coach Hall, actually began on the night of November the 26th. That's when the season began against SMU. And when the regular season was over, Kentucky had compiled a brilliant record, 25 wins and 2 losses, and their 31st SEC championship. We've come to the campus here in Lexington to be with some of the Kentucky players and Coach Joe B. Hall to get their thoughts and reflections about this year's team.
the manner in which we went about going to the championship, about our plans, the way we conducted ourselves, the goals that we set early in the season, and even several seasons before, dictated the way that we behaved in the tournament and preceding the tournament. We really did have a countdown. We actually counted the game minutes as we went into the tournament. We played each game in 40-minute segments, and before each game, we wrote the number of minutes left on the backboard to all the way through the championship, and there was no celebrating, and that is a fact. If people criticize us and say that we didn't have fun, then we laugh at those people now because of how much fun we are having.
No doubt about it, the Wildcats did have their fun. The NCAA tournament is divided into four regions, the Mideast, the West, the East, and the Midwest. Kentucky was in the Mideast with other teams like Florida State, Providence, Michigan State, Western Kentucky, Syracuse, Miami of Ohio, and the defending champions from Marquette University. The top-ranked Wildcats were matched against the Seminoles of Florida State in the first game. The two teams kept the score close at the beginning, but Florida State, with aggressive rebounding and full-court hustle, led by 7 points at halftime. This was somewhat of a shocker. Mickey Dillard, number 22, had a big first half for Florida State. But Kentucky had too much manpower. 6 Wildcats scored in double figures, and this basket by guard Kyle Macy put Kentucky ahead 54-53, and from there on, it was all Kentucky. They went on to beat Florida State 85-76. Kentucky's next opponent was 19th-ranked Miami of Ohio, not to be taken too lightly. In their first-round game, Miami had upset the defending NCAA champion, Marquette University, in overtime. But the Redskins had plenty of problems with Kentucky. Once again, everyone contributed, with 5 Kentucky players scoring in double figures. Final score, 91-69. In the Mideast final in Dayton, Ohio, number 32 of Michigan State, Greg Kelzer, gave Kentucky fits. His hot shooting put the Spartans ahead by 7 points early in the second half. But Kentucky stormed back. The steal and a breakaway slam dunk by James Lee tied the score, 35-all. The final minutes of the game belonged to Kentucky sophomore Kyle Macy. His flashy ball handling wore down Michigan State, and his perfect foul shooting beat them. In all, Macy made 10 straight free throws, 6 of those in 1-and-1 pressure cooker situations. Kentucky beat Michigan State 52-49, and this victory, like the others, was a team effort. Coach Joe B. Hall of the Wildcats understandably was proud.
In every game in the 5 tournament games that we played, there was a different way we won that game, and it called on maybe a different individual or a different strategy to bring about that victory, and our team was willing to make whatever sacrifice was necessary. And that adjustment, I think, was the big credit to this ball club, was their unselfishness, their ability to take advantage of an opponent's weakness with total disregard to their own personal role.
The Blue Devils of Duke were in the East Regionals together with Rhode Island, Penn, St. Bonaventure, Furman, Indiana, Villanova, and LaSalle. At Charlotte, North Carolina, a first-round game of the East Regional, and what a game it turned out to be. 32 seconds left to go, Rhode Island in the blue uniforms leading Duke 62-61. But Mike Gminski of Duke goes to the foul line, puts 2 in. Duke now leads 63-62. Rhode Island, however, has another chance. This basket misses, but look at this setup. And the ball goes off the front rim and out of bounds. The buzzer sounds, and Duke gets a squeaker over Rhode Island, 63-62. Great defensive plays by Mike Gminski highlighted Duke's next game against the University of Pennsylvania, the champions of the Ivy League. 3 times Gminski blocked consecutive Pennsylvania shots, this occurring in the second half as the Blue Devils rallied to overcome an 8-point deficit. Duke also getting some fine defensive work by Jim Spanarkel, number 34. Here he steals the ball. He also scored 21 points. Another hero for Duke, Gene Banks, just a freshman. In the end, Duke wound up on top. Another close one, 84-80. At the East Regional Final in Providence, Rhode Island, Duke took on high-flying Villanova, a team that had just upset powerful Indiana University. Relying on a fast break that carried them to a 25-8 lead and hitting 65% from the floor, Duke coasted to an easy 90-72 victory over Villanova and advanced to the Final Four for the first time in 12 years. In the meantime, the West Regional had eight more contenders: Arkansas, UCLA, Kansas, Weber State, San Francisco, North Carolina, New Mexico, and Cal State at Fullerton. In the first round of the West Regional, the University of Arkansas got plenty of help from its big three. Marvin Delp had 20 points. Ron Brewer, tossed in 19, was deadly from the outside. And the last of the big three, Sidney Moncrief, chipped in with 16 points. The Razorbacks winning it 73-52. Next for Arkansas came the powerful Bruins of UCLA. And once again, Moncrief got the Razorbacks off to a flying start with his driving layup. And then the fancy footwork of Ron Brewer ended in another bucket. Arkansas led by 13 points at halftime. But UCLA came out in the second half with a full court press and eventually narrowed the gap. A driving layup by Roy Hamilton tied the score 58-58. And then UCLA took the lead. Kiki Vandeweghe grabbing the rebound and scoring to put the Bruins out in front 60-58. But UCLA's shooting turned cold, and the Razorbacks outshot the Bruins en route to a big 74-70 upset, perhaps the most important victory in Arkansas history. The championship game of the West Regional in Albuquerque, New Mexico, matched Arkansas against the double-handed slam-dunking Mike Niles and his Cal State Fullerton teammates. Cal State at one time trailed by 15 points, but it turned out to be mighty close. In fact, Cal State took the lead in this jump shot by Keith Anderson. Arkansas then regained the lead on Ron Brewer's long jumper. Fullerton again called on Keith Anderson. He drove into the key, but he couldn't hang on to the basketball. Moncrief recovers for Arkansas, tosses the ball to Jimmy Counts, who scores as time runs out. Arkansas wins it 61-58. Arkansas fans were delirious because the Razorbacks became the first Southwest Conference team to make the Final Four since 56. One more finalist was to be determined at the Midwest Regional. The teams were Notre Dame, Missouri, Utah, Houston, Creighton, DePaul, Louisville, and St. John's. Notre Dame easily beat Houston in the first game, 100-77. But the Irish had a little tougher time against Utah. This basket by Tom Chambers put Utah ahead 44-43. The Irish, however, kept plugging away and finally won this tough one 69-56, setting up a meeting in the finals between Digger Phelps on the left and 64-year-old Ray Meyer, the coach of DePaul. The Blue Demons kept it close, in fact, trailed by only 5 points with a little over 15 minutes to go in the game. It actually became a two-man battle between number 40, Dave Corzine of DePaul, their scoring leader who was playing with a broken finger, and Kelly Trepuka, number 44, whose red-hot shooting inside kept the Irish in the ball game. In fact, put them ahead 47-46 with less than 12 minutes to go in the game. Notre Dame then scored 11 straight points. The dam had broken, and the Irish went on to win 84-64. A big victory over the Blue Demons from DePaul, putting Notre Dame in the Final Four for the first time in Notre Dame basketball history. And so it was on to St. Louis, to the Checker Dome, where four teams were still alive. Notre Dame and Duke were there. Arkansas, too, and those loyal Kentucky fans to cheer on the Wildcats and coach Joe B. Hall.
Whenever we take the floor, it's with a feeling for all those people that I guide the Wildcats.
Kentucky's opponent would be the Razorbacks of Arkansas, 31-3. Kentucky was 28-2. However, in the first semifinal game, it would be Notre Dame, 23-6, against the Blue Devils of Duke, 26-6. In that first game, both teams got off to a relatively slow start. Oftentimes, Notre Dame tried to work the ball inside to Kelly Trepuka. And many times, Duke would come up with the basketball. The Irish hurried some of their shots, and combined with a cold 38% shooting from the floor, they quickly fell behind. Duke, meanwhile, used their fast break to perfection. The Blue Devils outscored the Irish 14-4 in the closing minutes, and not surprisingly, boasted a commanding 43-29 lead at halftime. As it turned out, the story of this game was the great comeback by Notre Dame. The Blue Devils knew it was going to be a tough struggle in the second half. They realized the Irish had to go all out, and that Notre Dame did do, hoping to catch Duke at the wire and perhaps even win it in overtime. They used their muscle under the boards as Bruce Flowers powers this one in. Moments later, the outside shooting of Duck Williams. A 16-footer drilled. Williams then came down, knocked the ball loose, dashed down court. And it was here that the Irish trailed by only 6 points. Kelly Trepuka misses, but the ball goes out of bounds off the fingertips of Gene Banks of Duke. The Irish have possession, and they pull to within 4 points, 84-80, on this heart-stopping shot by Duck Williams of Notre Dame. Moments later, the Irish got the ball back after two free throws by Duke, which made the score 86-80. Notre Dame kept the pressure on, patiently working the ball outside, looking for the good shot, and then it came. Tracy Jackson from the corner, and Duke's lead is cut to 4 points, less than a minute to go. But Jackson committed his fourth personal foul, sending Jim Spanarkel to the free throw line with a one-and-one situation. Spanarkel calmly made both shots, and Duke was ahead 88-82 with 44 seconds to go. Seconds later, Duck Williams connects from his favorite spot on the floor. And immediately, Notre Dame calls timeout to set up a full-court press. Spanarkel throws the ball in. He gets it back and dribbles up court. But for one of the few times in the tournament, he made a mistake. The ball is just off the mark, goes out of bounds off the fingertips of Gene Banks. Duke ahead, 88-84, less than 25 seconds to go, and Tracy Jackson gets the ball for Notre Dame. He stops, shoots, and it's good. The Irish now trail by only 2 points. Again, Notre Dame applies deep pressure, and it works. Dan Wilcox comes up with the ball. 13 seconds to go. The Irish give it to their hot hand, Duck Williams. He gets the shot away cleanly, but is just a tad short off the front rim, and is recovered by John Harrell of Duke, who's immediately fouled, much to the displeasure of Coach Digger Phelps of Notre Dame, who had frantically been signaling for a timeout. Only 9 ticks left on the clock. Harrell makes 2 free throws, and the game is over. Duke wins it 90-86, which provides an unforgettable moment for all the Duke fans and players. On to semifinal game number 2, the Razorbacks of Arkansas against the Wildcats of Kentucky. Kentucky controlled the opening tip, and the Wildcats appeared to be off and running. But Arkansas had other ideas. The Razorbacks were one of the top defensive teams in the country, relying on the speed and quickness of players like number 10, Ron Brewer. He breaks up this Kentucky pass and winds up with an easy 2 points. In the opening 5 minutes, 5 different players scored for Arkansas. And the key to their success was once again defense. Again, Ron Brewer comes up with a big steal. And he stuffs the ball for 2. As it turned out, Arkansas's aggressive defensive play got them into early foul trouble. Steve Shaw, the Razorback's 6'11 center, already had 4 fouls with a little over 13 minutes to play in the first half. And his teammate, number 42, Jim Counts, another Arkansas big man, picked up his 4th man in foul trouble. Arkansas had to make some adjustments on defense. However, the Wildcats couldn't take advantage of that possible weakness and led at the half by only 2 points, thanks to this basket by veteran senior player James Lee. The score at halftime, 32-30. With the issue still in doubt and with 20 minutes of basketball yet to be played, both sides felt the championship was very much within their grasp. Coach Eddie Sutton of Arkansas kept stressing to his players to maintain their coolness, keep the pressure on the Wildcats, and work for the high percentage shots. Neither team was really able to take command in the second half. This Jack Givens rebound bucket put the Wildcats up by 5, 16-32 to go. Arkansas never lost its poise. The Razorbacks kept chipping away, scoring on plays like this, a beautiful sweeping hook shot by Steve Shaw. And at the other end of the court, Kentucky continued its fine play. Jay Scheidler making a nifty pass to Mike Phillips, who scores from the baseline. As the game progressed, Arkansas at times had only 1 man on the floor taller than 6'4". The Razorbacks were kept away from the boards, and finally, with 6 minutes and 19 seconds to play in the game, a crucial moment came. They lost their big man. Number 30, Steve Shaw, accumulated his 5th personal foul and had to sit out the rest of the game. However, instead of folding, Arkansas regrouped and fought back. Sidney Moncrief's layup cut Kentucky's lead to 4 points. Kentucky scored, but Marvin Delph kept the Razorbacks close with this beauty. Moments later, Alan Zahn's rebound on a missed free throw cut the gap to 1. The Wildcats got a couple of free throws. Arkansas got 1. And then with 1:55 to go, Kentucky leading by 4, came perhaps the most significant play of the game, as explained by Kyle Macy of Kentucky.
It was something that we had called, and we've used it before during the year. A lot of people said they'd never seen it before, but we had used it. But it was a big play. It kind of got our momentum back going and stopped theirs.
It was a big play, all right, as Jack Givens made the easy layup. But there was still lots of time for Arkansas. Kentucky kept the defensive pressure on, did not allow the Razorbacks to work the ball inside. Eventually, Arkansas had to go from the corners. This shot missed by Delt, recovered by Kyle Macy after the try for the points. Macy controlled the ball from here on, doing what he does best, dribbling and keeping his opponent at bay.
It's a kind of a personal pride thing when you get the ball and they are pressing you. You want to show him that he can't stop you.
And 3 seconds later, the game was over. Coach Joe Hall of Kentucky shaking hands with Coach Eddie Sutton of Arkansas. The Kentucky Wildcats would now play in the championship game of the NCAA tournament for the seventh time. And once again, the final score, Kentucky 64, Arkansas 59. In the battle for third place, some 48 hours later, the Razorbacks were in another hair raiser. The score, 69 all, 10 seconds to go, and Arkansas would take the ball out of bounds against Notre Dame. Number 10, Ron Brewer, proved to be the hero of the hour. Just before the final buzzer, he turns and rifles the ball toward the basket, and it goes in cleanly. Arkansas wins third place in a 71-69 thriller over Notre Dame. And so it came to the championship game, the matchup of a young Duke team, maybe the youngest ever to appear in the finals, a team that matured under Coach Bill Foster. Their opponents, the experienced, hard-nosed Wildcats of Kentucky, a team rich in basketball history. This Kentucky team played under heavy pressure all season. The success of their season would be determined in the next 40 minutes. Coach Joe Hall never had a more important game in his 7 years as the head coach of the Wildcats. Duke came out running against Kentucky. Their crisp passes shooting from one player to the next. The Blue Devils always looking for the open man. But both teams were tight in the opening moments, so most of the action took place under the boards. Number 20, Eugene Banks of Duke, battling number 53, Rick Roby of Kentucky. Indeed, a power struggle. On the other hand, Kentucky certainly was in no rush. Wildcats took their time and in the early going relied on the playmaking of their guards. On this play, number 22, Truman Clayner, spots James Lee and floats it in for the stuff. Duke also had some big plays, like the upcoming hook shot by Mike Gminski. What an ending. Patience again paid off for the Kentucky Wildcats. They moved the ball outside until number 32, James Lee, slipped a pass through the tight Duke defense to Rick Roby, who scores on this power move. Overall, both teams played in spurts, and eventually, Gene Banks of Duke tied the score at 22 all. The pace slowed for the next few minutes. Kentucky still trying to crack Duke's zone defense. Duke was coming out and chasing the Kentucky guards. And so the Wildcats adjusted. Number 21, Jack Givens, moved into the post position near the foul line. And things began to happen. Givens scored on this jump shot from the inside. And what followed was one of the greatest one-man performances in the history of college basketball. Time and again, the Wildcats found Givens all alone in the middle. And time and again, he took advantage of it and scored. Jack Givens truly was unbelievable. He still wonders why Duke didn't change their defenses to try and slow him down.
I was expecting them to change their defenses around, go to another lineman, but they stayed into that. I think they were thinking that if they brought the big man out, then that would leave Rick and Mike open and they would get the baskets on the inside. I don't know if they thought I could continue hitting, and I didn't know if I could, but you know, I was fortunate that they kept going in, and I was just lucky that they were giving me the shots.
It was more than luck, it was pure talent. Just look at his moves on this play. In all, Jack Givens scored Kentucky's last 16 points of the first half. The Wildcats led by 7 at halftime. Coach Hall really was not surprised at Givens' performance.
Well, there's no question that the middle of the Duke zone was weak. Because I understand that Coach Foster had encouraged his guards to go out and attack us a little more because he needed turnovers and felt that he was down and needed to come back. Now, you're caught in a tough situation when you're trying to play a zone and you're 6 or 8 points down and you need more pressure. And as you apply that pressure, you have to give up something. And if you maintain control or defense on the basket, then there becomes an area around the free throw area that is open and you are vulnerable.
Duke had stayed in the game in the first half because of their near-perfect foul shooting. The Blue Devils made an eye-popping 20 of 21 free throws. Really no surprise since Duke led the country in free throw percentage. This basket by Harrell brings the Blue Devils closer. Then Kenny Denard scored on a tip-in, his first points of the game. Kentucky then added another basket, but Eugene Banks missed two free throws and Rick Roby grabbed the rebound. He passed the ball to Truman Clater on this play, who in turn fed off to Kyle Mason. Play continued for a few seconds until referee Jim Bain stopped the action. Bain had called a technical foul on coach Bill Foster of Duke, who apparently complained that Clater had committed a violation when he had the ball. Kyle Macy coolly made the free throws on the technical, and suddenly Kentucky seemed to come alive. In the next few minutes, the Wildcats played with unusual intensity. This Rick Roby reverse layup put the Wildcats ahead 64-50 with a little more than 13 minutes to go in the game. Kentucky continued to be hot. Givens misses on the jumper. Roby rebounds and he misses. But guess who's in the middle of the action? You're right. It is once again Jack Givens who adds to his point total. The Blue Devils were not about to quit. Jim Spanarkel comes down, hits from the outside. Swish. The score now, Kentucky 66, Duke 52. There is still plenty of time for Duke left on the clock. On this play, Duke goes inside. And the man they want is Gene Banks. His basket, that's Kentucky's lead to 9. Coming up, perhaps the most exciting play of the tournament. This spike by Rick Roby.
I guess I was at the right place at the right time, and it was I was able to accomplish it.
The timing was absolutely perfect. Scheider lets the shot go, the ball comes off the rim, and back in it is jammed by Roby. And speaking of spectacular moments, the next two plays of Jack Givens are classics. He shows amazing body control and hits from just about everywhere. This shot from the side hits the backboard and spins in. Givens' final basket gave him 41 points, only 3 shy of the all-time record in an NCAA championship game. Kentucky seemed to have a comfortable lead, and as the seconds ticked away, the Wildcats began substituting the seniors. Out came Rick Roby, hugged by his teammates. He'd scored 20 points and pulled down 11 rebounds. It'll be a moment he'll always cherish.
Well, I tell you, it's kind of a sad moment, but I tell you, there's no other way to leave. And being the NCAA championship team, and I think Coach Hall tried to play everybody on the team so that everybody had a part of it. And I was glad that we had the opportunity to be able to play all the players.
Number 21, Jack Givens, received a hero's welcome. His brilliant performance in this championship game will long be remembered, especially by Coach Joe Hall, who knew him best.
Jack had a great attitude going into the tournament. In the final game, I think that he had all the confidence in the world, and it wasn't hard for his teammates to see that he had that confidence. He was scoring a lot off the board. He was coming up with steals. He was doing all of the things that an alert ball player with his ability can do.
Meanwhile, the championship game still was in doubt right up until the end. Duke staged a brilliant comeback, and this Mike Gminski jumper made it 92-88 with 12 seconds to go. But it was too late. In celebration of winning the national championship, James Lee officially ended the game with this thunderous stuff. Once again, the final score, Kentucky 94, Duke 88.
In that meeting, Tom, is that it had been an unusual year for a college basketball team. But our players had accepted that role and played it very well. And the one thing that we had for us going into the finals was excellent preparation, both physically and mentally. And our team was in the frame of mind to meet that challenge of a national championship game, better than most teams that find themselves in that situation. But if you look back at the ball clubs that have won the NCAA championship in years past, you'll see that they were disciplined clubs. They were clubs that went into the game knowing what they were there for and not just having a good time. It is a very serious time if you want to win.
Now, I guess you'd already planned by this time to attack the Duke zone from the, what you consider to be a weak part, sort of in the middle, and get those 15-foot jump shots. Is that right?
I wish I had, Tom, but not completely. We had good zone offenses planned for Duke, their defensive set. And I believe that these zone offenses would have been good. But in running one of these patterns, we saw that the middle was open. And Duke suddenly sent their guards out high to pressure us a little more. They were trying to create turnovers. They were playing more of the passing lanes. And we have a standard offensive set when that happens, is that we try to go inside into the post area to get the ball to a good shooter in that area. And Jack just fell into that role. And naturally, he was our best shooter from that spot. And that's the person that we brought in. We were surprised that the Duke players did not come out and challenge him more. And when they did come out and challenge him, we knew that Jack could had the talents and the mobility to beat their big people. And it created a little mismatch in our favor. Of course, Jack did one super job. He made some unreal moves, and he faked and feinted and stepped inside and did all of the things that a player would do that was in just great mental preparedness for the game. And his mental discipline, plus his great physical ability, were what made him successful and led to our victory in that game.
Okay, now about the time that the television, the national television, came on the air, just a few minutes before tip-off, think back, and what were your thoughts about this time?
They were all on the game, I assure you that, Tom. In a setting like that, you just, nothing else gets into your mind. You're one single-mindedness, and if you call it tunnel vision or whatever, but nothing penetrates that floor area for a coach going into the game. All of your thoughts are concentrated within the boundaries of that playing floor. And I've said this many times, that if someone had asked me what kind of crowd we had during a game, I couldn't tell them. I couldn't tell if it was a loud crowd or a quiet crowd, a full house or an empty house, because the concentration is right there on the floor with the players. And my thoughts prior to the game, my concern is mainly for our mental attitude going into the game, whether we're up for the game, whether we're I have no question about our physical ability and our ability, our preparedness physically for the game. My concern is our mental attitude going into the game.
Okay, you set the scene for us. Let's see it again.
It's